Welcome back to the Long Leg Inn. Come, sit down and listen. The adventurers from Of Dice and Men are about to tell us a story.
Hello, and welcome to another episode of Histories of Pethuania, the fourth one. This time, we're going to be talking with a few select friends here, and you can see them this time. But we're going to be talking about the incident of Telvarath.
Incident is a good descriptor.
So we'll start off with introductions, starting from, well, I'm Jerry, you know me.
I'm Tim, I play Roxy Nickeltrack.
I'm Rihanna, I play Cassia Lectiator.
I'm Danielle, I play Raga Oakley.
I'm Connor, I play Cantankerous Bill.
Alright. So, they're going to be leading the story this time. So, who wants to start? Okay, Danny, you got the timeline, so what happened first?
I kind of put myself up for that. Alright, well, I feel like I should start this off by saying the first part of this happened when it was Connor and my second time with this group.
Yep.
First proper session. Mm-hmm. The session before it had been a Christmas special.
I missed that. I was sick.
Yeah. But so it was our first time playing
so
with you.
Good.
Yeah.
Mm. It was so good, man. You should have been there.
I know. But God, elbow infection, man. You know?
It was so good, though.
Yeah.
Elbow infection. That wasn't good.
Nah.
The elbow, no.
But yeah, so our characters kind of sort of didn't really know each other, and we decided that bounty hunting would be a good way to
pass the time
while we try to think about the things to do. So we found a few bounties and we headed out towards Ferncombe. And along the way, we found one of the bounties, or one of the bounties found us, which I don't think, if I remember right, didn't have a very high chance of happening.
Oh no, it was a pretty low chance of happening.
At that point, sorry.
3% chance?
3% chance wondering where you were that you would encounter one of the bounties, and there was a 10% chance out of the 3% that it would be that one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But like at that point, I think we were like on a streak of low percentage encounters.
I thought that was the start of it.
I think that was the start.
Yeah. Yeah.
Under 5% encounters.
Yeah, we basically had like how many of those? Maybe
3 or 4.
I want to say 4 or 5.
Yeah.
All below 10%.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Every single one.
Yeah, and they were never nice encounters, Jeremiah.
Oh, some of them were nice.
We did
in the end.
Yeah.
After you kill them and take their stuff.
Yeah.
I feel like we also should mention, like, you said that at that point we didn't really know each other. Like, we haven't, like, the audience doesn't know the characters either. Like,
how about a bit of an introduction of the characters and what they are, who they are, and what they do.
Okay.
Because I feel like that's integral to some of the stuff that happens.
Some of the developments.
You start, because you've got a lot.
Cantankerous Bill. The first thing that he tried to do in-game is cast magic in a magic-prohibited city and then lie to a guard about it, which basically sums him up fairly well. He was, at the start, fairly off his rocker. Not 100% there, and that was kind of my excuse for not really knowing how to play D&D, and he's a little bit better now, because I'm a little bit better now.
So what is Cantankerous Bill?
Oh, right, he's a halfling, and he's an arcane trickster, and most importantly, he's a little shit.
He's also, what, 60?
I mean, yeah.
Physically 30.
Physically.
Now, right?
Yeah,
yeah,
well.
Yeah. I mean,
well,
that's
now,
another thing.
But back then, he was.
Things change.
Mentally, he's.
You
like,
get younger.
Mentally, he's like 5, but also a genius. But.
Sorry.
Yeah.
He's a savant.
It's a savant,
you know. Braga's a half orc. When it started, she didn't have much of a backstory.
Yeah,
built
up as we went.
It kind of just, rose as we were going.
Thanks,
She has a lot of gung ho. She has a lot of enthusiasm. She has a good heart. She's very stupid and very impulsive. And that led to quite a few scenarios that certain players do not let me forget about, because I'm also sometimes impulsive, and I'm going to blame that on my character. At the beginning, Bill and Raga did know each other. Bill liked to climb on Raga and just kind of be up there because she was tall and he was not. And I think that's about it. That's the groundwork.
Raga is also, her hometown is the place they're going to.
That's right, yeah, as we figured out later. She comes from Ferncombe. And she's a cleric of Rictoros at the time.
Yeah.
Mm. At the time. Cassiel, or Cass, is a paladin of Shorai. She was originally from clan of Wood Elves, but for all intents and purposes, it's Maktar, raised in the temple of Shorai itself, so she's familiar with the Protectorate, and she's also the reason why we ended up in the Protectorate area. She used to very much be the downer of the group, in which everyone wanted to go off and do chaotic things, and you had this lawful good paladin going, no.
Yeah, we call those a babysitter.
She was a babysitter. Cool. She's also got 7 intelligence, so...
Make for interesting control. Character stuff, honestly. Roxy is a half-elf bard, which pretty much tells you a lot of what you need to know about him. He likes to perform his music. He likes to have sex, which is like, originally those were his two main character traits. For the first couple sessions, I would basically turn up and like, just kind of go, well, I don't know much about this, so I'm gonna, like with Connor's thing of Bill being nuts and that being his excuse, my excuse was like, oh, he's drunk, or oh, he's hungover, but as time went on, that kind of went away, and he grew out of that as like he was given more and more responsibility within the
campaign.
But yeah, he is from Soru. He was raised by his two dads, who run Ela's Shield, which is a tavern in Soru, which players may go to. Whoa. but yeah,
hashtag the shield.
His mother disappeared when he was a very young boy, like 1 year old or so, and his dad's opened the tavern to like honor her and stuff. And yeah, he started adventuring because he found his father's journals as well as his mother's. And basically went, hey, you guys did some really cool shit. I want to do really cool shit. And his dads were just like, you're 19. We're going to think about it for a second. And the next day they were like, yeah, no, there you go. You can do it if you want to do it. And now he's a kind of responsible 27-year-old. So...
How old was he when the Tel'Varath stuff was
happening? When the Tel'Varath stuff was happening, he was about 26.
Yeah, it's only been like a year.
Yeah.
It's been 2 years, I think, altogether.
I think we worked out it was like 2 or 3 months until Roxy's birthday in the new year, two years after.
Because his birthday's in like May.
Yeah, so is Cass's. So she was 29, now she's 31.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah. Nearly 2 years. Well, 2 years in game is.
Wow.
Whew.
1 year in. 1 year out of game.
Yeah.
Yeah. Bill started out as 71 years old. Now he's like 33.
Cheating.
magic.
Okay. So.
Yeah.
The party was all traveling, heading towards Ferncombe, initially for some bounty hunting. Some bounties ended up hunting them, and they encountered their, for some. The first real big fight they had, which was interesting.
Yeah.
That one was Krogal the Destroyer.
Happily named.
The ogre who wielded a tree had a whole bunch of cronies and a belt
that stopped him
from dying.
Yeah, that was that was an interesting item.
Yeah.
Still around.
That is one of my favourite items. I loved that belt.
So,
it's mine.
Yeah, I know.
So how that functions is, when your health hits, when you die, instead of dying, the belt activates. But you don't know how long for. It could be 2 rounds, it could be 8 rounds. But it's been a point of interest several times where someone goes down and they're like, oh, how long do I have? I'm like, oh, I'll just roll the dice behind the screen. And then I'm sitting there counting down, but they don't know how long they've got. Mm. That was always fun. I enjoyed that. I still do.
Anyway, we beat him up.
Yeah.
Eventually. We took his head off.
Yeah,
Then I raised him as a zombie. which was also fun. Oh. We decided, because we knew he'd been attacking trade caravans, we decided to check his lair in case there were survivors. Mm-hmm. If I remember right. Also, mm-hmm. probably we kind of wanted loot.
Yeah,
well. I mean, probably definitely. Yes.
Yeah. So we went to find a lair, and on the way we found a mimic. If someone wants to take over on this part.
Oh boy. So yeah, we found this chest, and like this dwarf was near the chest, and when we saw this scene going down, we were told to turn around, I think, either by the, just by a voice, right? Or it was like, we were told to turn around by a voice, and so we turned around. And then, when we turned back, the dwarf was gone, and the chest was, you know, licking its lips, as so to say, so to speak.
The chest did have lips.
It did have lips.
Yeah.
Surprising.
It was terrifying. And then the chest introduced itself as Archibald...
Sir Archibald Denwolf the fifth of...
Lorassic. Yay.
Oh,
I love how you
point.
Started that, then we just had to keep feeding you bits of information for you to add on to it.
Listen, I don't take notes.
He had a lot of titles.
Lesson one, take notes.
Unless you're like me and get anxious about taking notes. but we found him. A lot of us were definitely for killing him immediately. I'm not sure about...
As well as, like, Bill wasn't. I don't know who else wasn't for killing him.
I don't think Roxy was for killing him, because he was like, this is kind of funny, honestly. Plus he
was
kind of drunk.
I think Lafleur.
At the time.
I think Lilzer and Lafleur were for keeping him alive.
Yeah.
We should introduce them, too.
Yeah.
We had two other party members who aren't with us today.
Yeah. They're still here. They're just
not
here.
They're here. They're alive.
Hey, everyone, I'm there.
So, Lethlin, who is an elven monk from Maktar, worships Shorai. Surprisingly enough, him and Cass had seen each other in passing occasionally. He also trained in a monastery far away, but that passed over time. He's old. He's an elf. They're all old. And then you've got Alina.
No.
So,
Alina
isn't with the party yet.
Okay.
Lilza
yeah.
is with the party.
Yes.
Lilza was a gnome barbarian.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Raised by badgers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is good because I never actually knew what Lilza was.
Ah.
I was kind of like, is she a honey badger or is she...
No, she was
no.
Is she
that was
kind of like
by...
a... Is she a... poorly disguised goblin.
That would have been
no,
would
she
have
had
been
a goblin
like...
stomach.
No, she had a penchant for collecting bits.
Yeah.
She liked
eating raw meat.
Another thing that would have contributed to your confusion was the fact that we would use a badger mini for her.
Yeah.
Because we didn't have a small gnome.
The only gnomes I had were little men gnomes with shields and swords, and that wasn't.
That was
I can't remember what weapon she used.
A club.
Yeah,
I know a lot. She was like claws and teeth.
Yeah, it was literally just a big stick.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of funny.
She was the brains of the operation.
Oh, and
yep.
Cass
of course.
Taught her how to read as well.
Yeah, so that was good emotional attachment.
Yep.
She imprinted on you like a puppy, didn't she?
She did. She she had Cass, when we got to Hunza, I think she had Cass custom made a ear cuff that also had sapphires on it and had Shorai's symbol engraved on it because she really
fancy.
Liked Cass, and I think Cass and Lilza were actually closer than Roxy and Cass were, and because Roxy and Cass are the only original surviving members
from the original party.
The original party started off technically about, what was it, 6-8 months before
yep.
yeah.
Before this story begins. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so that's a different story altogether. But this one, so they encounter Sir Archibald, here on referred to as Archie. Forever. And how'd the encounter go?
It went pretty well, actually. Not terribly. Not as terribly as it could have gone. We could have got Vord, honestly. They told me not to say Vor, but
eaten. Dead.
Vord.
Didn't happen.
Consumed whole.
Masticated.
Swallowed.
Okay, we can stop.
Sorry.
sorry. It's fine.
You're anyway. Not.
So.
Anyway.
This is what happens when I'm in front of a camera.
We were all varying degrees of suspicious because he was a mimic.
Mm-hmm. He literally ate someone like a second before you guys saw him.
But he was polite.
He's very polite.
He assured us he wouldn't be eating someone for another few days. And we were like, we can probably figure something out by then.
He's like, oh, I'm very sated. Ooh.
Luckily, we had some magical, very magical special cookies.
Mm. Yeah, from the Christmas special, these cookies were essentially cure-alls. They would fix... Each character only had one of them. Or was it two?
One.
And they would fix anything. It was basically like a get-out-of-jail-free card once. It was like a Christmas present, basically. Because I'm a cheapskate and give imaginary things. But they had these. They could use them at any point. You know, one of them just so happened to choose to want to use that on an NPC that had been around for quite some time and was cursed quite a while ago. And so instead of actually having to do the quest arc to fix that, it was cured with a cookie. Not the first time that's happened.
Wasn't Archie's predicament like literally a Beauty and the Beast situation where he was like, "Oh, you." He was like to a hag or a witch or something, and he was like, "Ooh, you shit." And then she was like, "Well, you're pretty shitty as well. Be your fucking chest now."
I mean. You're not far gone there. Like, to be honest, it's scarily close.
Yeah, he wasn't
to be fair, Jeremiah.
He was a little bit racist.
He was a haughty-taughty nobleman.
He was.
Rugby wasn't appreciative of that.
No.
Orcs were not regarded highly where he was from.
I think I helped fix that a little bit.
Yeah.
At least as far as he's concerned.
Yeah. Having his ass pulled out of the fire so many times by you guys kind of.
Well, he kind of cowered and told us where to shoot.
He's like, "Hey, I know these things. You hit them there. Oh.
hit it there. The most obvious weak point you can see."
He gave us bonuses.
Yeah, it gave us bonuses,
wasn't
but like
useless.
Yeah,
that's flashing red.
You see that exposed wound? Hit it.
To be fair, Jeremiah, you gave us the cookies.
Yeah.
That was your doing.
Oh, I know.
You were the architect of your home.
That's the story of my life.
Yeah.
So, did Archibald actually have a quest arc?
There was a whole quest associated with him. I'm like, okay, so they run into him there. Then they've got a choice of either going on this other quest line or they'll go to this area and find this thing and we'll go on about that. And since Archie didn't have a quest line anymore, you guys just kind of went into the lair and did that one instead.
So we just clipped through the floor right to his...
Yeah, basically. Well, yeah.
We drank three Red Bulls in a Denny's parking lot and clipped right through the answers.
Anyway, we went to the lair. And there wasn't... If I remember right, there wasn't actually much loot there.
No.
Apart from one very special necklace.
There were a few bits of, like, eaten boxes, wrappers, and rations and other food. Stuffs, but nothing.
A necklace,
huge.
Though, if I remember correctly, that was actually hidden in like blankets or something. And
yep.
The only reason we found it is because Lilza loved to tear things apart to look for shinies.
And I knew that.
Yeah. She
you
found
put
it
there deliberately so Lilza would find it.
Well, I said it as a quest.
Yeah.
That was the start of the first big campaign. It just started a little differently to how. I thought it was.
What would you have done if we were like, oh, we don't want anything to do with that, and then just like dug a hole
and
put it in there?
And then you know what I'd do? I'd write a new campaign like I do every other time.
Oh, but like, Lilza burrowing into stuff was like a... Wasn't it like in the first couple sessions, you had to think of stuff on the spot for her to find because you weren't counting on her going,
ooh! It's like, oh, we're here for an hour and a half. What are you gonna do? I'm gonna dig in the dirt with my hands as deep as I can go. What do I find?
I'm gonna tear open this pillow.
Oh, I'm gonna tear out this guy's intestines. What's he been eating? So the goblin's been eating, bugs.
We went
some people. And some rabbit hair.
If you can get Jerry to come up with something on the spot, count yourself, like, just give yourself a pat on the back. Because it's honestly an achievement. He thinks of everything. That's a lie.
I make it look like I think of everything.
And it's working,
exactly.
Obviously.
Exactly.
So, this amulet that Lilza found... Now, earlier on, there was a dynamic between Lilza and Cass where if Cass would tell Lilza something was evil, instead of sneaking up on things or, you know, being rational, she would immediately charge in, all screaming and...
Barbarian.
So they developed... Cass sat her down and basically went, okay, now, when I detect evil, I'm going to go... If I do that, it means it's evil and don't do anything. So that was their code, and it actually managed to work until she found this amulet and asked Cass if it was evil. She told her it was. Asked Bill if it was magically made. He told her it was. With these two points in mind, she decided to put it on.
And then it fused to her skin.
Now, we all, not all of us, but some of us made initiative checks to try and stop her from putting it on.
Failed.
Yeah.
Convenient time for people to roll ones.
Mm. Yeah. Bill didn't try because he thought the whole thing was hilarious.
Bill is not a good person.
Bill is not a good person.
No. We then tried to pull it off and quickly realised it was actually attached to her skin.
Yeah.
And then we made our first stupid decision.
We didn't kill her.
We just kind of went, let's figure it out in the morning.
Well, Cass didn't want to kill her as well. Hmm. She was close to her.
Well, she was still normal.
Yeah. to be fair, there was no obvious change in anything yet.
Just
the
that it was
fine normal.
Just that, like, the fangs in it were stabbed into her chest.
Yeah, it was bad, but
Cass's hope that they could figure out something to fix this, but so she stayed up to watch her just in case, well, people rested because, you know, you needed to heal up and have your spells all reset after this ogre encounter.
Mm.
And Lilza became possessed.
Mm. There was a will save involved. It was a 2. It was DC 10.
Oh, no.
Oh, God,
was only
really?
DC 10?
Yeah.
That would have been
every
so
time
easy.
She slept, it was DC 10. It just so happened to happen instantly, and I'm like, well, I guess this is happening sooner.
Okay, cool.
Oh, wow.
I mean, the thing, like, it did have, like, jagged little bits in it that just dug into her skin, didn't it? Yeah. It may as well have just been flashing, like, now assimilating.
I mean, on the plus side, at least it happened in a cave out in the middle of nowhere, as opposed to, like, in a tavern with people.
Oh, God, yeah.
So,
I mean, I was kind of hoping for that.
When you were already
watching
her.
So what actually happened was, like, we were all sleeping. I think we had to actually make will saves,
too. Cass wasn't sleeping. She was watching her. She
That's
up.
Right. You were, like, paranoid.
Oh,
right.
No, well, she was less paranoid, more wanting to, I don't know, just make sure she was okay.
Yeah. Being a concerned friend.
I mean, Cass's whole thing is being protective and self-sacrificing as well. Hell, so.
Bill wanted his 40 winks.
So Lilza stood up and was suddenly very hungry. Incredibly hungry.
For people flesh.
For people meat. And so she tried to, and that was when combat broke out between the party.
Mm-hmm.
Now at this point they had several things they could have done to try and restrain her, but every single one just happened to fail through either bad luck or good luck on Liz's part.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
It was very unlikely that it went down like it did, but it did. Eventually, Lilza was defeated by the party and killed. That wasn't the end, though. The amulet, once the soul of the body had departed, the power in the amulet seized control of the form that was left. Now, the body itself couldn't contain this energy, and so all of the meat, the bones, the muscle started to burn away. The bones ended up fusing with a special kind of lightning and created almost like a skeletal lightning fiend. And this is where round two started.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that was surprisingly close as well. Now at this point, this lightning fiend, it had a quarter of Lilz's max health, and it lost 5 hit points each round as it slowly deteriorated under the amount of pressure the energies within the amulet were putting on it. It didn't help much, as by the time this lightning fiend was defeated, a lot of the party were worse for wear.
Mm-hmm.
Some were down, they were still not fully recovered from the fight with Krogal and being destroyed. And unfortunately, their new fancy belt hadn't had time to recharge yet.
Who actually got knocked unconscious that fight? Because I don't remember. I think Bill just went straight for the kill.
I think it may have been Lafthing?
I think, yeah, that sounds
good. I'm not sure.
At that point,
this is a long time ago.
At that point, Lafthing wasn't like big punchy yet.
No, he was a little punchy.
Yeah, he was a little punchy, but not like big punchy.
Yeah.
Ranks, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was just all knives because I had no spells left.
Yeah, I don't quite remember what happened at this point.
Okay, so after the fight, what happened was they defeated the skeleton. And the skeletal fiend began to shake and shudder before the bones and the form gave way and the energy contained within the amulet began to surge. Now, the amulet was just sitting on the ground, nothing left to hold on to. But they were like, this is evil. Let's destroy it.
Yeah,
let's get our giant ogre friend with his giant ogre club, the dead one, to smash.
No.
That's not how it happened, Jeremiah.
No, see, this is why it's important to know that this was Danny and I's second, maybe third.
That's just our second one.
It was second one.
Yeah.
First proper one.
So we're like, wow, that's an evil item and nothing else. We should probably destroy it so that it can't do any more evil.
Which is a fair assumption.
It's a fair assumption for people who don't know better.
So everyone but Bill, Raga, and Lathlian left the cave.
Oh, the dispel.
Yeah, man.
Oh, I forgot about that.
What did that do?
I'll tell you, just keep going.
Cass is kind
of like, don't think it's a good idea.
Yeah,
please
magic wasn't her thing, so she wasn't exactly sure, and she also has 7 intelligence, so.
And I didn't know,
Raga,
and Bill was like, what's the worst that can happen?
Yeah. Bill was crazy. Raga was stupid.
In hindsight,
Lathlian was parental supervision.
Yes.
He failed.
He tried, though.
So, Bill, in all his vast 14 wisdom.
That's pretty decent,
actually.
Yeah.
He cast Dispel Magic on the amulet, and it got through.
Yeah.
It actually managed to dispel it.
He got a nat 20 on his roll to overcome an item. Now, obviously, when it's focused on an item, it doesn't dispel it permanently. It's just a temporary shutdown. And during that time, I rolled the rounds. It was only going to be one round that it was down for. Not enough time for what was in there to escape. But there wouldn't be an amulet left after that time.
Because that was when Bill told Raga to smash it, and Raga did not hesitate, and she smashed it with her very big axe.
Yeah.
Wait, didn't you get...
I'm pretty sure it was...
No, it was outside the...
She literally brought an axe down on it.
I just...
And, you know, a...
immediately...
copper amulet. Yeah. Some gem and some glass. When it's not magical, doesn't stand up to much. So it shatters. Boom. The big bad of this campaign was free about a month of real life time before I had anticipated. So everything kind of got stepped up a little faster.
You didn't play. Okay. How was that supposed to go down?
So you guys were basically supposed to go, oh, we have this amulet. Oh, well, the party being as they are, fairly new, in liking finding loot, would go, we found this. Let's go find out what it does at the nearby town. You'd go to Ferncombe, you'd be like, hey, we have a thing. What do? And they'd be like, cast identify. Oh, it's containing something. Oh, it's containing something. It's containing X thing from years ago in the past. But, and then you'd get sent out on a quest to basically try and re-imprison it and put it somewhere safe, but there was something was going to happen.
Just gonna shove it in the bag of holding and forget about it. Just be lost in that kind of nothing space.
You see, I had something in case that would happen. There were people trying to hunt the amulet down to free it, and so simply having it in a bag of holding or on someone's person wasn't going to be good enough.
Toss the bag of holding into the ocean.
And let it in. Anything that touches it then breaks it and it's
then
just floating.
Yeah, then it's like
there's no protection. Locate object is a spell that people can get.
Yeah.
So, and then as you get to this area, then there's going to be a giant fight, which was going to result in either the amulet being stolen and then released, broken and then released, or if you successfully imprisoned it, then the campaign boss would be the people trying to get the amulet instead of him himself. But that didn't happen.
So, wow. The amulet was destroyed. And then from the amulet comes this massive, massive, refresh my memory, is a chromatic...
Blue chromatic
dragon came out, who announced himself as Telvarath the Black Thunder. Black Thunder. Right.
Yeah. Lightning would have made more sense, but no, it was a Black Thunder.
Yes, Black Thunder.
He was a young dragon who wasn't looked on favourably by other dragons.
Mm-mm. Yeah, it's a long and complicated past involving betrayals, lies, and unfair imprisonment, at least to begin with.
But yeah, he was released, and for releasing him, he gave us, we can request one thing of him, right?
Yeah,
and we requested to leave without...
It was Laughlin specifically asked us to...
Let us leave.
The guy who plays Laughlin is so funny. Like, he'll just come up with these really witty remarks, but just straight faced.
It's amazing. Yeah. The best deadpan snarker you've ever met.
It completely catches you off guard.
I have to ask, though, did that actually, him asking that, did that change anything?
Yes.
He was going to kill us.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. I wasn't
kill
going to kill you.
You're not going to finish that sentence, are you?
No.
Okay, cool.
Aww.
But yeah, he agreed to let us leave without killing us, which we left without him killing us. But then he let out this massive maniacal laugh kind of thing and disappeared in a bolt of lightning.
He did say to tell Ferncombe that the Black Thunder had returned. And also, who was it that considered collapsing the cave on him?
That was the original plan.
I did, as I know now, I did not have the ability to do that. I thought I did. I did not. It would have been a terrible idea.
We trusted you with that. But
oh, you...
Yeah.
You shouldn't have trusted me with so much.
We were like, yeah, no, Raga can do that. That's fine. We didn't question it, and we should have questioned it.
Should have. I think I questioned it.
We started questioning stuff after that. And just each time we questioned you a little bit more until we hardly let you do anything.
Yeah. But yeah, we basically left, and as we left, black clouds started gathering around everywhere, and everything around, all the plant life and stuff, we were just all crumbling and dying.
Mm-hmm.
It was not fun, not
purple
a good
lightning.
Image.
There was purple lightning.
Purple lightning.
I want to take a moment to remember.
Yeah.
This is the beginning. Phew.
Sure. Hey man.
Speaking of low percentage chances, right? So second session, I'm a wizard. I have a familiar.
Mm-hmm.
I sent my little birdie to go tell fern comb that stuff's gone to hell, and off he trots, off he flies, and I never hear from him again.
He struck down in a bolt of purple lightning. It wasn't fun.
Literally, he just never came home.
Yeah.
What percentage chance was that, Jeremiah?
Well, you see, you remember when I asked you to make a reflex save, and you're like, "What for?" And I was like, "Just roll it."
It wasn't a okay.
Yeah, it was basically from when he left you to when he got to the thing.
Mm-hmm.
There was a chance he got hit by a single bolt over the course of the storm as it homes in on life, which is why all the plant life was crumbling as it was.
Mm.
You guys coincidentally had the protection for a bit of time, so you didn't have to worry about that for the first half of the journey. And after that, there was some percentages involved as whether or not you got struck before then. Now, at this point, it wouldn't have killed anyone. It would have just been a bit of a shock, literally and figuratively. But for poor little birdie that had half of your low health at this level, with a bit of a failed save, doesn't end well. It was only 2d6 damage, but because he was by himself,
there
wasn't much that could be done.
Mm-mm.
He was ash in the wind at that stage.
Yeah.
And, so I went through basically the entire campaign up until a couple of weeks ago.
In real life time,
when I got another familiar.
The same
familiar, but
with some upgrades.
Yeah,
Gregory 2.0.
His name was Gregory. He's lovely. He's little albino raven. I love him. He's my son.
One of my.
We'll get to that.
Yeah.
Probably. Maybe.
But yeah, when the sky, you know, it started turning black, plants started dying, and there were purple lightning everywhere. We started to realize, hey, that's not a normal dragon.
Mm-hmm. Can blue dragons do that?
Yeah,
no.
Also, I was very scared, Jeremiah.
Oh, that's good.
First proper session, you throw a blue freaky dragon at us.
Yeah.
I just set the bar high. Extremely intimidated.
It was a bit scary, and Rihanna wanted to turn tail and run, but Cass was intent of marching the party straight to Ferncomb.
Yeah.
Which is what she did.
Yeah. Bill was fucking pissed for his bird.
Oh,
understandably
yeah.
So.
Yeah. So, the party eventually gets to Ferncomb, which is now currently all boarded up. There are wards, the gates are closed, there are black thunderclouds overhead,
mm-hmm.
and the land around it is barren.
Mm.
Now, like I said, this was supposed to be endgame territory for this campaign before, but I had to find a way of integrating the same effects with the start of the campaign. And so these guys arrive and they're like, hey, we'd like to come in, we've done something that we need to tell you about. And they're like, no, you stay out there, we don't know who you are, we can't trust you. And this is one of the points that Archie came in handy.
Mm-hmm.
So Archibald is a noble. He knows how to talk the talk and how to get through all the political walls, so to speak. And he'd seen them and they'd saved his life several times by this point. And he had become a little more friendly towards them, or at least trusted them a lot more.
He was human
at
this point.
At this point,
just some really posh mimic.
Yeah, that would have not gone down well.
Did have an undead headless ogre following us as well.
You did.
That probably didn't
But you
help.
Did specify that you'd leave that 200 feet out of the city.
Yeah, I did. And he was wearing women's clothing.
The ogre or Archibald?
Yeah.
Women's slacks.
We didn't dress up the ogre, did we? That's
no.
I wish we did. We could have given him a nice business suit.
He could have been
the hired help.
anyway, what did Archibald actually say to his sin?
So basically, after the guardsman threatening you.
That's right, because we took his sword. He, when we fed him the cookie, he threw up all the stuff he'd been eating.
Yeah. Which conveniently was most of his own equipment. His clothes weren't of any use at that point, so he had to borrow them from
where Cass's clothing came in.
Yeah, that was interesting. His sword was his badge of office. You know, it's the every nobleman of Lorassic has one of these, whether it be tailored to their specific house or them personally, or even just their family.
Mm-hmm.
And so they had his badge of office, and he needed that. And so it was a bit of a moment of trust for the party to give that back to him before what looked like they were going to get arrested. And so he ended up going through. He convinced the guard captain to speak to him for a bit first before passing any judgments or anything like that. And so they went behind closed doors for a bit. Came out about, I think it was 2 hours later?
Mm-hmm.
And came out, and he'd managed to bargain enough. So instead of just getting sentenced or worse, the party simply needed to assist Ferncombe in recovering from the damage dealt.
Community service.
Yeah.
Yep.
Glorified community service. And so that's where they met Alina, who was the player who was playing Lilza's new character.
Because that was irrecoverable.
Mm.
Yeah.
That wasn't going to happen.
Yeah. Not at the level you guys were at.
Little baby level 7.
And so that's when they began their small quests to go about the campaign that I now had to create from the end game.
Suck it.
Yeah.
Wow.
It turned out okay.
What did you get?
I had no idea.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Good job.
So not only do we ignore the campaigns you had set up by accident, we also skip through most of
The ones you do, you skip half of.
Yeah.
We're not skipping half of this one, are we?
Oh, no, I feel like we're actually...
You've skipped 4 parts I had written up.
What?
3 parts initially, and then an extra one fairly recently-ish.
Next session, we should just go to the boss.
No!
Just knock on the front gate. Come on.
Fight us!
And that, yeah.
We're level 23!
You wanna go?
Yeah, these guys have grown quite a bit. So, the first quest out of Ferncombe.
That was the Dragon Temple.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
Did we do that
first?
That went well.
Yeah,
we did that first. That went mostly well.
Yeah.
It was mostly a puzzle thing. Mm-hmm. Archie came with us, got his leg chopped off while underwater.
It
wasn't
really chopped off, it was more
let's
like
chronologically.
It was crushed off.
Yeah.
So chronologically, let's build up to that. Because that's an important point.
There's
like,
not really much to
we're
go
giving
into.
Them something to wait for.
Yeah.
So there was a bunch of metallic and chromatic pillars that we had to like do something with outside to unlock the door, and then we went inside and there were statues.
Yeah. So you had to pay reverence to the right statues in order to gain entry to the temple. Once in there, you would find out, whether you noticed or not, or realized, that the temple was functioning as somewhat of a gateway. While it housed statues, altars and the like to Bahamut, Tiamat, and a few other minor draconic gods, there was also several points throughout there that hinted at a bigger picture behind this. Something a previous party had set up, and another party had visited. Another party had attempted to ruin. Wild mages suck. But anyway. So, these guys went through, and there were a few hints dashed around the walls and in the plaques. I'm not sure whether you guys picked up on it, but this area also acted as somewhat of a gateway between the Realm of Dragons and the Material Plane.
No, we got that.
Yeah.
There were dragons coming out of the stonework, literally. So, like,
cool.
Yeah.
So at this point, that gateway was closed.
Mm. Until dragons started coming out of the stonework, literally.
Yeah.
The gateway was still closed.
Right, and that's
mm-hmm.
an important point.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a bunch of puzzle stuff that we have to do. We have to go, you know, collect silver key to open gate 1, and then go collect bronze key to open gate 2, etc.
Get the boss key.
There was
boss
a
key.
Literal fight we had to do, and I realized I was actually forgetting to add damage, so I almost actually died when it should have been a lot easier.
Yeah. I was surprised at how little damage you were doing. I'm like, well, this came really bad luck.
But Cass was doing a combat trial one-on-one because we figured out that more people taking the trial would mean more enemies to contend with as well.
Mm.
And at that point, Cass was like the most tanky.
Yeah.
So.
Mm-hmm. She was the most tanky and can do the most damage in martial ways. So she was the one to do it. And I forgot that, yeah.
Mm. I think that was the first time Bill actually did something altruistic as well, because he actually... It was sealed off with some kind of magical barrier, so I cast Blink and phased through and splashed you with some healing.
Yeah.
I mean, we were I'm thankful, but Cass was like, that's cheating.
It was cheating. And yeah.
Yeah, we got an, there was like another opponent. That
he can't. Yeah, another opponent came along. Yeah. So it wasn't cheating, even though.
Yeah, it did.
I feel like it should be mentioned that while we were going through here, Bill found the pedestals that ended up being part of the final puzzle, looked at them, went, oh, that's a magical device, I'm going to disable it. Somehow managed to disable it when it was a very high roll.
I disabled everything. There's an automatic door that would let us out. I disabled that.
Yes, indeed,
there were the pedestals that we needed to actually complete the whole thing. I disabled those.
Yep.
As well as like the actual traps that were there. I tried to disable most of those.
And then you had to re-enable them.
I had to fix the magical device, yeah.
That was interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Cause it was
just party wipe from starvation.
There was this moment where you guys were like finished up and the exit would normally open and you could leave. But I'm sitting there and you're like, what do we do now? And I'm just like, well, the room is quiet. And nothing happens. And they're like, oh, did we miss something? Is there something we haven't done yet? And they spent about 15 to 20 minutes in real time searching that room, top to bottom,
mm-hmm.
everything, mm-hmm. looking for the slightest point. They even rolled a natural 20 on searching the walls. And they're like, ah, did we find any secret doors? No. There's no secret doors here. There's nothing here. There's no exit other than the way you came in. They just looked at me in disbelief. And eventually they went back through, and about half an hour later, they finally discovered exactly what they'd done.
Yeah,
and at that point, there was about a solid 10 seconds of silence as everyone just turned and stared at Connor.
The first of...
And that was the
first
look.
Of
that
silence.
Was the look.
He hasn't changed that much. He's still disabled.
Everyone has had some pretty substantial character development.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm still going to break shit.
Yeah.
There is still a lot of times where we end up just glaring at one person, though.
In particular.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Surprisingly, most of the time it's not me.
Yeah.
That you can see.
Sometimes you're looking down at dice and counting things we're all looking at, you just.
Simultaneously.
Yeah.
Yes, that's a lot of dice.
A lot of the time it's not even like a conscious decision we make, it's just we all just.
I mean,
all of us are just looking at you.
That's fair. It's kind of my job.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We all look up as one and then just turn.
I mean, I don't decide that I don't dissociate out of it and I can actually pay attention to what's happening, so it's not a glaring thing.
Oh, it's fine. No, I wouldn't care if you were glaring.
We're all just staring into space in your direction.
Yeah.
Anyway, so we're going
Anyways,
through this thing.
Yep, and we ended up getting through the horrifying water puzzle where Raghav got nearly crushed in half.
Roxy figured that out.
Yeah, thank you.
Because he was like, okay, it was like a... this is one of the few times where I've actually figured out a puzzle, so...
It was a big moment.
The big moment! First time that Roxy figured out a puzzle as well. Well, second time.
Well,
first time was like, just like a real easy thing that he did with language stuff. Which he doesn't even know.
Incidentally.
Anyway, so, there was a big, tall room. Was it? It was tallish, right?
Yeah,
tall room.
25 feet, I'm pretty sure it was.
Yeah, we activated a thing, and then it started filling with water. And Roxy eventually figured out that we needed to get the water to a certain point. But at that point, several of us would have been drowning. But we still did it. And it solved the puzzle and stuff, but then we were just stuck in a big room filled with water at that point for a bit. So...
But we got out of it.
We got out of it,
yeah! And we dodged past and fought past the portal to hell.
Yeah, that was opened
was
by...
Just there.
Wait, no, rewind, because we skipped the bit where Archie got his leg crushed.
That was during the water bit.
Yeah.
It was in the water when we were all trying not to drown.
Yeah,
they were like these big stone crushers thing. You ever seen Galaxy Quest? Like those.
Yeah.
So we had to drag an unconscious body who was leaking blood
He was lighter, though.
We managed to
yeah, a third lighter.
Yeah.
We did manage to stabilise him. He was still unconscious through the rest of this.
Yeah.
Didn't
we give him another one of the cookies to grow his leg back?
No.
No, we took him back to Ferncombe.
Yeah, and then he got his leg restored.
And I waited until we woke up and told him off for being snarky at all of us when we went to a lot of trouble to save his life in that freaking temple.
Yeah.
And I lost a shoe.
Oh,
Was
it fortunate?
I'm surprised we didn't lose any more body parts, honestly.
I mean, you guys, the only reason Archie lost it was because there was two natural ones in a row involved.
Yeah.
And then
true.
No one managed to roll higher than a 10 on the initiative check to try and pull him out.
Terribly on the strength check.
It was the
check
only
for that
trap
spot
that I didn't disable, and he falls into it.
Yeah.
Yes.
Really upsetting because I thought we'd actually lost him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so they got out of that. They went to the next room. In this next room, obviously, this is a place that other parties have been. One of those parties had a wild mage. One of those parties with the wild mage wild surged and created a two-way portal to another plane. That plane was, it was like a strange mixture of hell and the abyss. It was like a prison powerful creatures are held. One of those has become quite prominent now. And this creature managed to escape. And the wild mage, in his wisdom, decided, I'm out of here, and so teleported away. But this prison changes things in it, so they are technically objects. They do not have a pulse, they do not live, they do not breathe. They can move, that's it. They can't use any abilities that need to target creatures. Sort of like a defense mechanism, because everyone who gets put in there is absurdly powerful, and if they're able to use their abilities, can just pop out. No real issues there.
Okay.
And so he latches onto the wild mage. The wild mage teleports back to his boat. They didn't have a boat after that. And from there, this big creature has gone to grander things. Things that we're dealing with now. But these guys come across the remnants of that. The portal. And a few of the critters that have come out since. Nothing too crazy. The area's been shut off for quite some time. And all of the ones that could have spent time have gone back through. So they come in, they kill these things, after a bit of a struggle, and then they go towards the giant final area. The doors that were closed, and the room where the exit would be made for them. So the door opens, and they see ahead, they see a huge statue. I'll let you guys continue this.
That statue had it was a dragon with five heads.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we had two religious characters. Oh, no, we had more than two. We had a few characters of low intelligence. And none of us, I don't know if any of us rolled high enough to actually recognize what that statue was.
I did, because I have knowledge.
Yeah,
we did, because you tried to sense evil.
So, don't try and detect evil on an evil god, guys.
You pass out.
You're lucky that's all that happened.
I didn't realize that would happen. I didn't even realize that she was a god until, like, half a year afterwards.
Oh, really?
I didn't wish she was a god. Oh.
Now, to clarify, this is not the god herself. This was an aspect of her. This is basically her image on the mortal plane, as at this point, she could not do anything else. She could not influence much, and she was more or less confined to acting through this statue.
Her PR rep.
Yeah. PR.
We needed a disc. The disc was behind the statue. The inscription said something along the lines of, leave your sacrifice.
Prostrate yourself.
Prostrate, sacrifice, take the disc. We decided to not do those first two things and just take the disc.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't approve.
She the statue came to life and she was going to eat us.
Yeah.
And Cass, while absolutely hating her because evil.
Mm-hmm. Were you still unconscious by this stage? When did you
know I became conscious again by this point.
yeah.
Because we took a while in there.
Oh, okay.
And also not wanting her friends to be eaten, decided to set aside her pride and grovel to her in attempt to bargain for their lives,
mm-hmm.
in which she requested us to make personal sacrifices to her. We had to give her the item that we had the most personal attachment to, meant the most to us.
Mm-hmm.
So, does everyone want to talk about what they gave her?
Roxy gave her his loot, which I hadn't, like, said the significance of yet, because, like, it hadn't come up in-game, and, like, at that point I was very much, like, Roxy's stuff was very much off the top of my head, and it just happened as it was happening kind of thing. But, like, the loot was a significant thing for a while, in my head at least, that was given to him by his dad, the one that is biologically related to him. That was given to him, it was a gift from both his dads when he started, actually pursuing playing the loot, which was, like, the first time he played the loot, one of his dads was out, and got injured on, like, a raid or something, and couldn't play that night, so Roxy stepped up, and for the first time, didn't use his full name of Roxuron, and went by Roxy for that performance, and, like, performed his loot, which he'd been practicing for a couple years, performed on his dad's loot, and then, like, about a week later, his dads gave him his own loot, because he was like, dude, I fucking loved that. That was really good. That was such validation, my dudes. Damn. And that's, like, where he fell in love with performing and stuff. But yeah, the week after that, he was given a loot by his dads. And then that was the loot that he presented to Tiamat.
It's Tiamat's now.
Except
I didn't communicate all that beforehand.
So the personal attachment didn't actually count.
It didn't count, but let's just
pretend.
I'd like to think it does. Because it was still very important. It was important to him,
yeah.
like even without mentioning that, it was important to him because, like, that was how he cast his magic. That was how he inspired the party and stuff. So, but after that, he got a sweet loot, which was literally called the sweet loot. So,
yeah, quite some time.
Anyway,
Raga gave up a hand carved hair comb that was her mother's, I believe, because.
Mm-hmm.
She was very close. She is very close to her family, and cares a lot about them. And it was only our second session, so I still hadn't really figured out her backstory much or her personality much. So I'd talked to Jeremiah before this and I was like, can she have something from home? And that was all I had. And other than the equipment, I was like, this is probably more important to her. I'll throw that in.
Bill had nothing sentimental on him at all, really. Like, the same problem with you is, like, I had 2 weeks to come up with this character, like, 2 sessions. So there was nothing really backstory-wise that I had in mind for him, except that he went nuts because a thing happened, and now he's just on the road doing whatever catches his fancy. So I figured, I don't know, I'll give you my hat. Because it's a snazzy hat and he liked it.
He had enjoyed his hat for the 2 sessions that he played.
Yeah.
He did enjoy his hat. It was a very nice hat.
Yeah.
It's a really nice hat.
Now Tiamat wears it on one of her heads.
We're going to fight Tiamat at some point. She's going to have like
a singular
hat. A little halfling sized hat.
Ear warmer.
Yes.
We're like going to have to make a spot check to see it.
And yeah.
I can't remember what Laflian gave up, and I can't remember what Lena gave up. And we did have this NPC that was with us that I don't actually know what happened to, but he was like, oh yeah, I guess I'll give you my journal. I can make another one.
Oh, the crazy guy who was
there.
Shit.
Yeah.
I have no memory.
What the hell did he do after that?
I can't remember. He just kind of disappeared and we never spoke of him again.
He was like a homeless guy and he was just living there and then he...
We were all kind of homeless.
It was just a homeless guy.
No, not really.
Thank you for taking another one of the F-bombs. I was sick of hogging them.
I was noticing you were doing that. And so Cass, I was thinking about what he would be most attached to.
Yeah.
And I was going to give up her holy symbol of Shorai. until I remembered. And as soon as I remembered, I knew it was the most important item to her. She took off the ear cuff that Lusa had given her, and Lusa was dead, and they were close, and Lusa looked up to her, and she taught her how to read, and so she gave the ear cuff that was personally made for her and given to her by Lusa, and that was what gave the extra points to get us actually at that check, because
it was a rating
from 1 to 4, and I was the only one that gave up something that was actually on the 4 scale, and we got 12 points altogether. I remember that.
Yeah.
So, she did some sort of breath weapon on all of it to destroy it or something, as kind of like, I'm going to destroy the things you love and suck it kind of thing. But I can't remember if that was exactly what happened.
It's basically
yeah. So with that, she was satisfied, probably still disgruntled because, you know, she'd been pissed her off a few times after that. So
revenge for my hat.
Look, I'm sure it's fine, guys, and certainly had no far-reaching consequences.
Not at all.
And yeah, it was fine.
She forgot about us. And do you guys remember the reason that you had to come to this temple?
No.
Yes, to get
help from the dragons.
Because they didn't like Tel'Varath, because Tel'Varath was basically,
an upstart.
He was pretty much the equivalent to a rebellious 15-year-old.
Yeah.
Hmm.
So, in order to go there, we had to make a deal with them. And the deal was that if we rung the bell in Ferncombe, then all of the dragons would be released and come to aid. But, as a consequence, all of the dragons would be released.
Chromatic and metallic.
Both of them.
Mm.
For good. As far as we were concerned.
So, up until this point, in the world, there were a limited supply of chromatic and metallic dragons. All had been surviving for quite a long time. As there was a long war that happened many years ago that resulted in the metallic dragons sealing themselves and the chromatic ones in a separate plane that we refer to as Drakendom.
Trademark.
Until a future date. Now, this seal was in effect until what they thought was a near impossible event, being Tiamat helps good-hearted people a certain number of times, a large number of times. And coincidentally, this would have been the last one, as when people are desperate, they will reach out to anyone who looks like they may have power. And in these guys' case, it wasn't them personally. But the city of Ferncombe was quite desperate seeing the return of Tel'Varath, and at this stage didn't much care for their opinion on things. For better or worse.
Yeah, you know, I'm actually kind of sad that that didn't end up happening, that we didn't get like a new resupply of dragons, because now all the ones that we have are getting out of date.
Past like, their use
like,
by.
How
yeah.
are we going to make all this
Look,
dragon
no,
scale armor?
You have to
sniff
zap
them. They'll be like, if they smell, we'll know
if
they're if
there's
off,
any,
if, they
if there's any
with.
Mold on them, just cut it off. You're fine.
I'm personally happy that they were never
yeah.
released.
I mean, with this low supply of dragons, it's not like people just there just wouldn't be any armies of dragons going around.
Well, not anymore.
That's certainly happened. Anyway,
we
found out about the deal, and we headed back to Ferncombe.
Mm-hmm.
That's not before we talked to the rather more better tempered gold dragon upstairs.
Oh yeah.
Who
actually did get released?
Yeah, he was out and about.
Yeah.
Or at least a portion of him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So
that's nice.
Yeah, we actually managed to find a.
Wasn't
we,
that?
We unfix all the doors and then go back to the main chamber.
Thinking back now, wasn't that like Bahamut?
The gold dragon. What
color is he?
He
Bahamut's
was
Bahamut
platinum.
Is a platinum.
Okay.
Ah.
No, this is gold.
Yeah,
yeah
actually,
gold.
That.
Hmm?
Hmm.
Hmm.
Hmm. I'll look into that later.
yeah, I was just thinking, considering what recently happened.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. anyway, yeah, so I think it was on our way back that we encountered our other very low chance encounter, which was a young red dragon. Who we were supposed to have help with, but we killed it too quick.
Yeah, so there was an NPC I had keyed up to basically join these guys and help them. And I was like, okay, so he'll come in X amount of time after the fight begins. Oh. The fight ended the round that he showed up. And so he didn't actually help at all, because the one chance he had to help, he fell off his mount. So that was great for first impressions.
Yeah.
You really need to stop doing that with the whole roll to see when they come, on what round they come in, because it's always after
always right
the last quarter
health. It has also created some of the best moments that I've seen.
True.
So it's something that I'm quite fond of.
All right.
If it's something key, very important, then I'll have it at set point.
Yeah.
But for optional things, then the extra time is...
Have them show up like 5 minutes after the battle, like just...
I mean, that happens from time to time.
Hey guys, what I miss? Oh, shit,
everything.
Okay.
Everything, yeah.
So, they defeated the dragon. They got back to Ferncombe and explained the current situation and what they'd learned.
Mm-hmm.
And then the next task.
That was recruitment. That was going to... No?
It was going to Condroc. Sorry, I didn't realise we meant the same thing.
Yes.
Recruitment in Condroc.
Yeah. Condroc. It was recruitment. It was in Condroc.
I can't remember is this one, so you guys can...
Is this is this Emerald Hunter and Pay of Justice?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah.
Ah, so we went to Condroc to recruit the help of the Pin of Justice and the Emerald Hunter. When they were described to us, we were basically given, well, at least I was anyway, probably due to massive bias, that like the Emerald Hunter was the really cool guy, and then the Pin of Justice was the dickhead. We met them. Pin of Justice was the cool guy. Emerald Hunter was the dickhead.
Cool.
No, not like cool as in like he was a chill dude.
He was a fun time.
He was a fun
certainly
time.
Certainly more fun than the Emerald Hunter.
Hey,
so Condroc
is in his place. It was nice.
Yeah.
Condroc is a hive of scum and villainy. It's
yeah.
It's basically Agrabah but with less laws and.
It's Agrabah and Gotham City at the same time, but
worse. Yeah, that's
it.
That's
actually, yeah.
Yeah.
Good way of putting it.
Yeah.
I just think
also,
Gotham City because vigilantes, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, that was the first place. This is where Bill got into his first street fight.
That's also where Bill got turned into jam.
First and last street fight.
That was my first death.
Yeah.
It was actually my first death, and it did absolutely, it affected him not at all.
That was my first revive, I think.
It did affect him because he was like, ooh, what's on the other side?
No, that's right, he became a little bit fascinated.
And that's how he got the special eyes.
For like 2 days, and then
like
he was
two
like,
days.
Yeah.
Then he forgot about them, and they stopped happening.
Yeah, and then he had something different, but anyway.
Yeah.
So, little old Bill. They're in a tavern. They're trying to gather information about the people they're seeking.
Oh, God.
Anyway, so Raga decides to go down and sit down at a table with this mountain of a man.
Mm-hmm.
They start talking.
Boy.
They get along okay. You know, things are going all right. The way that they're talking, they may get some information. Or a couple of pointers. Bill decides to come and join the conversation.
Erroneously.
And eventually picks a fight with the guy.
He didn't look that strong, I could take him.
His arms were bigger than Roxy's torso.
Yeah.
So, Bill is very smart. At this point, he did have an intelligence of like 19 or 20.
Yep.
At level, yeah, whatever. And he figured that if there were any real vigilantes that could actually help in the situation, they would take issue with a big, strong guy beating on a little old man who is defenseless and obviously not in his right mind. So
at least one of those
picking on a poor geriatric.
Yeah. So yeah, he decided that hey, I can manipulate this guy into doing what I want, which is apparently pacing me on the floor.
It was what did he hit you like twice and you were dead? Something like that?
See, I would have been fine, but I didn't read my spells properly. I thought gaseous form moved faster.
Just kind of...
The entire party was watching this happen because we all figured Bill had an escape plan.
Yeah.
Because Bill was the smart one. So Bill must have a way out of the situation, or at least delaying it.
This is how they learned that Bill doesn't plan.
We learned that very quickly when you were dead.
And there was just this moment. Like, when it got into the fight, and he's like, I'll use this. Wait, hold on a second. Oh, no. And he just looked up, and we're like, so what are you doing? He's like,
Are there any cracks for me to understand too? <Yeah.
laughs> Just like, no. He's like, oh, well, damn.
So, like, I played my part. I tried to make myself look as crotchety and meek as possible when it came time for this duel of fates. And, like, in 12 seconds... Like, you rolled for this too. Again, you did the famous roll to see when they came in, and it was like 3 rounds after I died.
I mean, to be honest, with that one, because you couldn't turn up instantly, it was a d4 plus 2.
Yeah.
So I rolled the lowest. It was just, you only lasted 2 rounds.
I did. I didn't do a very good job of staying alive.
Basically.
But he was also like level, what, 18 or something?
Yeah, he was level 13.
He was only level 13. That's still like. Yeah,
there's
5 levels
above. Yeah, there's a few levels above you. I mean, I never intended for you to fight the guy. I intended for him to be a helpful guy.
I intended for me to fight the guy.
That's the problem.
And then he ended up dying. I think we actually did end up killing him with some repercussions.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. He cursed you. Mm-hmm. You must have done the killing blow then.
Good times.
Yeah. That's fair. We got that fixed.
Yeah, but imagine if we didn't and some fast and large person on me.
God.
Wasn't he going to pop out of you or something?
Yeah.
Basically, he had a specific perk he had acquired through his adventures that when he died, he could attempt to throw his soul into someone else's body and lay dormant until certain conditions were filled and then attempt to seize control. Now, he wasn't a bad guy. He definitely wasn't a good guy. He was just a mercenary. They just so happened to pick a fight with him and kill him. And he wasn't very happy with that.
Fair enough.
But things turned out okay. Yeah, everyone's okay now.
Have you ever had enlarged?
Yes. Yes, I have, actually.
Have you actually? I don't remember this.
This was before
there.
Your time.
After, though?
No. Because the only experience Cass had with enlarged person, she was bumbling, useless, gigantic thing, and
you
she
lose
hates
your
decks. It.
Yeah,
like she was completely useless when she had enlarged person.
It was just bad luck.
I know,
didn't help
but
that she was
her
like,
experience was
exactly.
I don't like.
If
this.
You
wasn't that on the
cast
ship
enlarged
well?
Person and you just stay enlarged, do you eventually get your decks back as you get used to it?
Or? No, it's because you're bigger, so you're it's generally harder to balance.
Right, okay.
Because your weight is a lot. You're a lot heavier, and so gravity affects you more.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right.
Anyway, we found the pin.
Yeah.
The pin found us.
Yeah.
And we managed to talk him round. And I think the pin knew how to find the Emerald Hunter, so the pin was like, I'll take care of that.
He's called the Pin of Justice because he's this tiny halfling. He's a halfling, right?
Yeah, surprisingly short halfling. He was 2'3", I think.
That is tiny.
And he rode a cheetah as his paladin mount.
Amazing.
And he had a lance.
Yeah.
Amazing. I loved him a lot.
It was.
Some people don't like him as much.
It was so good.
The Emerald Hunter, on the other hand, he was like.
He's a douche.
He was an extreme version of Stephen Amell's Green Arrow.
I don't know what that is, but yeah. I agree.
Now, I think, out of all of us, was Roxy the only one who went to the information den?
No, Roxy, Alina, and Lathlian went.
No, but I mean, out of us.
Oh, out of us, Roxy was the only one.
I wasn't.
So we went into this information broker with the intent of finding information on the whereabouts or whatever, how to contact the Emerald Hunter and stuff. So we went in there. Before we went in there, Alina took issue with Roxy going in. Initially,
because She was like, you can't be trusted.
Because,
Oh, yeah.
And then Roxy was like, come on, we're like both Daryl's followers. It's fine. It's cool.
She's never forgiven you.
She's never forgiven him for this. Rightfully so.
Ironically, Roxy was not one of the untrustworthy ones.
No!
It was us.
Yeah, it was
really
you.
And we voluntarily stayed outside, like, no, it's cool, I don't trust me.
Was either. I in that session? Because I can't remember it at all.
I think you might have been away for that.
Yeah, I think you were.
But yeah, so we went into the information brokers, we got the information on the Emerald Hunter. We asked about Talvarath and where to find him, but they couldn't supply us with that information because they were under the employ of Talvarath.
Not that they told us that.
Not that they told us that. We figured it out in as many words.
Yeah.
So basically, we tricked them and asked if they could show us everywhere. He wasn't.
That was later,
that
I'm
was
pretty
later.
Sure. That was
no,
way
that
later.
Was later.
That was...
No, though, you did ask where he was, and they were like, he's here. And then we
That's
and
right.
then we were told
no,
later by a
fuck,
third
sorry,
party
I got
that
it out of
you do realise they get their information from demons and devils.
Yeah, right? I got it out of order. That's my
yeah,
bad.
So
you were given
spoiler alert.
That's my bad. I got too excited there for a second.
That's okay.
But yeah, so we got that information of where Talvarath was. And then with that we were like, oh cool, let's go back to Ferncombe. As soon as we got back to Ferncombe, we found out that, the city had been attacked or something.
There was something missing on the way back.
Yeah, there's
yes!
culpability
oh God!
That you're missing.
First thing for context a little bit, the way we got to Kolchak were these...
No, before we do that...
Rewind. Why does Alina hate Roxy?
Oh, yeah. Alina... No, but that's, when we... Yeah,
when you got that information though, on where Talvarath was,
yeah, was
you were told very
did.
Clearly not to tell anyone else.
Yeah, but that's later.
No, this happened at.
This happened
the,
at.
This
didn't at
happen
that.
At the. This didn't happen at Conjok. This happened back at Ferncombe.
Oh yeah, but we.
You were told.
At yeah,
Conjok.
At Conjok, you were told not to tell
yes.
anyone explicitly.
We were explicitly told
anyone.
Not to share this information
and
with
what
anyone.
What did Alina ask you to do?
Well, there was a reason behind this. Was because. They ended up putting the life of someone these people had met.
Yes, that's right.
As essentially collateral in case they had told anyone.
So Alina's backstory a little bit at that point had involved a guy from the information brokers, which we found out he was from them eventually later. But as far as she knew, she was just this guy who had a card for the information brokers and then we were told that the person who supplied us with the information to get to the information brokers would be in danger if we shared this information in any way.
Mm. And this person was someone who helped Alina when she got to Conjok.
Yes.
Essentially got her a job and helped her keep her stable and living for a solid couple of weeks, which in Conjok is very rare.
So as far as she knew, he was just a good Samaritan. But then... So yeah, that's for context for a later thing. The way we got to Conjok was these carriages, which, when you said some magic word, they sprouted legs and started sprinting through the desert.
It was so uncomfortable.
It was awful. But on the plus side, we found out about this new cool tech that they just invented. They were called seatbelts.
Yep.
Yeah.
Because apparently before you just kind of bounce.
Yeah.
All over the
place. But they were called safety belts. But
safety
they were
belts.
Seatbelts.
Yeah.
On the way back on these sprinting carriages.
Which
we
really did the suspension.
Yeah.
That would be nice.
Yeah.
Suspension is kind of hard to do with legs.
Yeah. Just put springs in the ankle.
They're organic.
Don't say it like that! God, it's even worse!
It's a wooden carriage with organic legs.
Oh.
They literally just look like giant human legs.
It's
yeah,
awful. It's really bad. Were they shaved?
I hadn't thought of that. So I'm going to say no.
Okay.
Oh,
cool.
Fuzzy legs. Fuzzy legs.
Fuzzy legs.
This was extra alarming to me because I wasn't there for the session. I actually got to Concha.
Oh,
no. Yeah. So this was sprung on me when you were leaving.
Anyway.
Oh, no.
So that
so
was fun. But yeah, so on our way back to Ferncombe from Conjoc, we had another low percentage encounter.
Now, pause for here. There's something in the desert.
Oh,
something that was caused by some people a long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of people just call it the no-no hole now. The no-no hole has been mentioned on many occasions in these, and it will be for the future. It's in the history of Pethuania.
Does
so
it have an actual name, or is it just referred to as the no-no hole?
It doesn't really have a designated name.
It's just...
It does have a designated name. It's called the no-no hole.
It's name. It's called what people call it.
Yeah,
and
we call it that.
So,
yeah.
In this section, it is a two-way bridge to the Far Realms, where things like Cthulhu, Elder Things, and a lot of those creatures exist. Now, this portal, it does. The area around is very unstable. And so the desert has this blotch of madness, where eyes open out of reality and stare at you. Creatures emerge from the sands, or beings from outside of our own reality reach through and touch people, leaving marks, leaving memories, or worse. And these guys on this route now, the trade routes had been moved to avoid this as best as possible, but the current other road was being constructed and was under a bit of duress recently due to the Tolvrath situation, so the workers couldn't afford to leave Ferncombe to get there to continue building the roads, and it was not stable. There was still a bit of a forest around the bottom of it there. It was very overgrown and not travelable. And so these wagons were currently going along the old roads. Now, this was mostly okay, as the speed they went meant they didn't have to deal with much. They basically skipped straight across it, and as long as everyone closed their eyes and looked down and, you know, followed the instructions they were given at certain points, nothing would happen. Sometimes people don't listen.
No,
sometimes those people are con.
Sometimes I tried to listen and then someone stopped me.
And so, at this point, they got a little too close. And there was a chance of something coming out. Now, obviously, because of how fast these carts are moving, the chances of something coming out that could keep up with them or that would have an otherwise meaningful impact on them is very small. 5%. 5%. Low percentages happen. You roll a lot of percentages, you're going to get the smaller results from time to time. These guys just happen to get it more than others.
Ever.
So, these things called Tyrants of the Mind. If you've ever seen War of the Worlds, those giant walkers, think something similar to that, only it's got four large fleshy legs. At the top, it's got a large brain with several small tentacles flailing around. At the end of each of these tentacles, there is a tiny eye. And they are also almost fuzzy. Think like a spider's abdomen. How it's got that little, those little hairs coming off of all areas, even the eyes. Anyway, when these things come nearby, reality kind of stops. It pauses. Everything ceases to be but the consciousness of those within. And these tyrants of the mind often move around. And if any minds are overly active, it will attract their attention. However, they cannot physically harm or touch anything unless they are looked at directly. And then once that happens, everything within a 20-foot radius of those who do is brought into being on the same realm and can be affected by the tyrant. These guys saw that from one of the carts ahead of them. There was no cart left afterwards, nor anything of the people within, physically or mentally. And someone got a little curious.
Normally, I think you told me this, normally looking directly at one of these things will just make you nuts. Or
it
like
will
melt
drive
your brains.
Insane.
It'll melt your brains, leak out your ears. While in Conjoc, I don't know how, I think we bought it from Hulva. we bought a quill and I didn't identify
that was mine, and I won it from one of the lucky wheel stalls.
Did.
And that's how Alina got wings.
Hulva's wheel.
Yeah, Hulva's wheel.
Yeah, the
Hulva's
wheel.
We had no idea what we had.
Hulva's wheel is
on a bit of a tangent. I was at this stage that I thought that every language should have an accent, so Gnomish was Russian from there on out.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we got the quill, and I didn't identify it for some reason. I just didn't prepare it that day. So instead, I just tried to test it out. I just wrote on some paper. So I wrote something. I don't remember what it was. Something about
like
colours.
And it involved me.
Yeah, it was Dear Diary. Today, I...
You're so lucky that you didn't accidentally curse Ra and have, like, two heads or something like that.
Yeah,
because like,
I was sitting...
You were probably just a word away.
Now, this quill... was unique in the fact that they won it and they got incredibly lucky. So this quill, what it does is, obviously you don't know about it, if identified, it will reveal the fact that the first three things written with this quill will come true, one way or another.
It was basically wish.
Quill of the wish.
But yeah, I wrote in it, and somehow out of the garbage that I wrote, I... got tetrachromia. I was able to perceive like the full spectrum of light, so I could see like infinite colors. And I mean, that's still a thing that
yeah.
I have. It's just not very useful, really.
Sometimes it is, though.
Sometimes
yeah.
it is, like in this instance. So everything was in a purple haze, and yeah, if you look directly at the tyrants, you go nuts. And I kind of figured this from a knowledge planes, I'm pretty sure. So I kind of looked at one that was far away, and usually the haze would actually blot everything out, except with my tetrachromia, I could actually make out the shape of one of them. And I think I had to make a will save for that.
Yeah.
And like, I think, yeah. So I actually managed to see one and get a description.
Which is pretty rare.
Hmm.
And I became a little bit... Like, that's when I stopped thinking about Limbo and started thinking about these things. Like...
Yeah.
I don't hold attention very long.
It's like a child.
He is
an old bearded child.
He is exactly a 70-year-old
child. It was
child.
So stressful.
He's the adult.
No, thankfully, Lathlian was the adult.
Yeah,
he tried.
So
we must have come very close.
You were about to jump out. One of y'all was about
I
to
was
jump
about
out.
To jump
yep.
out.
We stopped
yeah.
her.
Mm-hmm.
But it was very close, I think.
You would have killed all of us.
No, I'm sorry, but I didn't do it.
And so
you were going to, and it's the fault that counts.
But I didn't.
So they spent some time here, freaking out a bit, and it was fun. I enjoyed that. Thank you. Right, guys?
It was real
you
fun.
Would have enjoyed
wow.
it if we died and then no one was there to fix your freaking Telvera.
I wouldn't have enjoyed that at all.
You
would have
loved
it. I have to rewrite the entire campaign.
And we'll just keep on doing it to you.
What? Like you haven't already?
No, this is our next plan. After this campaign's done, we'll make new characters, start a big campaign, and then die halfway through, so he has to rewrite the campaign again.
Suicide pact. If we start doing
yeah.
anything important, we just kill ourselves.
Yeah. Deal. Deal.
That's not.
Deal
anyway, sorry, you were saying.
So, they eventually managed to get out. The caravan got the got far enough away from these tyrants that they could reactivate the legs, the wheels, and get out of there. And those things move ridiculously fast, so they were pretty much okay once they got past those. And upon returning back to Ferncombe, they realized the walls had been damaged. A lot of people were dead. The town itself had been attacked. And as they went through, they found out it was attacked by Telfarath.
Mm-hmm.
A sign of things to come. Which led to...
Man, basically... Seeing all this, it was like, we met up with the Black Judge again, Madar.
I think we mentioned him before.
No, we didn't.
But
we didn't
mention
him before. Yeah, we skipped over Madar.
So Madar, in Ferncombe, there are a series of essentially guardians of the village, known as the judges. Red, blue, black. And Madar, the black judge, was essentially the closest thing to their parole officer.
I didn't know it was a rank. I just thought he had a really sick name.
You didn't realize?
He likes his name was Madar. His title was the Black Judge.
Yeah, I know.
He was one of the leaders.
I thought it was a title. I didn't know it was a rank. I just thought he had like a really cool title.
I'm going to be honest, so did I. I don't think we were ever told about a blue or a red judge.
Yeah, we were. I paid attention.
Apparently, I wasn't there for a session.
That was being explained though, because that's before we got our yeses that we skipped.
I mean,
yeah,
physically,
right?
Yeah. Well,
apparently,
there's always something that at least one of us will dissociate through. So
usually one of us, but you know,
this is why it's important to have people who care enough about the campaign to actually take notes.
I care about the campaign. I just can't take notes.
I take notes now.
I can't take notes physically because I get too anxious about what I'm writing down and what I'm not writing down.
I'm the reason why we have a timeline.
Yeah.
Bless you.
We were told, we were caught up to speed from Madar, and basically told that we'd been gone for like weeks, two or three, I think.
It was 2 weeks and like 7 days, I think. No,
that's 3 weeks.
2 weeks and 6, because it was almost 3 weeks because the time you actually spent in Condom.
Okay. Yeah, so like we were gone for basically 3 weeks, and in that time, Ferncombe had been attacked by Telvarath and stuff.
Now, they had only actually been gone for their time for about a week and a half.
Yeah.
But that little stop with the tyrants may have screwed up with their temporal spacing a little bit.
Mm. But yeah, so seeing all this, Roxy was like, this is bullshit. No. And basically went, we know where Telvarath is. Which Alina took issue with and basically gave him a look. And it was like, I'm never forgiving you, look.
And this started a long-standing rivalry?
Rivalry?
Kind of? I don't
know. Not really, it was one-sided.
Grudge.
Because
grudge.
Alina
yeah.
just really...
As far as Roxy was concerned, that's just how their friendship was.
And
they just sling insults back and forth.
And he
Fun
does it
time.
Kind of jokingly, and she just hates him.
She just fucking hates him.
It's
which
changed
is like,
now.
It's
yeah.
changed
now.
They're
friends now.
They're a little, they've like, they've got a little bit more respect for each other, I think.
A few bonding moments.
They're
like work colleagues.
Yeah. They're acquaintances.
Yeah.
They can still get a little bit... Yeah, but...
Yeah. Well, that's going to happen when you have two bards.
Yeah, that's true.
The clash of egos.
So one of the points that she kept bringing up was what I was trying to prompt you to say earlier, was that she made you swear on Darylith that you wouldn't tell. And
you're like, who's Darylith? I don't know. Anyway, here's all the
information
we got.
I don't read it. I can't read all of a sudden. I don't know. But like... You gotta see his side here.
Yeah, I'm not saying that.
Oh, yeah, it made sense.
Yeah.
Cass fully supported
like,
this happening.
Yeah.
I had plans for if you didn't say and if you did say. If you didn't say, it meant that you would have to then spend time trying to find out where he was. If you do say, you don't have to do that. You've got to deal with the consequences of that. So
yeah. Which we did deal with the consequences of that.
He
basically told them where Telvarath was to the best of his knowledge. Was I correct about that, by the way? Did I, like, point out the right place?
That's right.
I need to know if I pointed out the right place, because I pointed out a place and I don't think it was correct.
So, Jeremiah actually got, Tim to actually point to the place where he was told where that would be.
Matt prints out.
Yeah.
So,
We were told where it was. Jerry showed us the map and went, it's here.
And then you have to remember that.
And you have to remember.
Stephen and Amanda were smart and took a photo of it. I went, oh yeah, no, I'll remember.
And it was so good.
I didn't think the city was gonna get fucking attacked.
Because you were like, I'm sorry, I have to break my oath. I know where he is.
And they're like, oh,
and everyone's
show
like,
us.
Hating
there
you.
It is.
It's like, now show us. And you're like, I don't have to. Can I just roll for it?
Yeah, so.
I didn't realize that.
The place you pointed to was, in fact, three islands across.
Damn it!
Later on, the party, Alina specifically, having seen it's already been mentioned, decided that she would at least make sure that the sacrifice, the potential sacrifice of the person that was being collateral, was not in vain, and told them the right spot.
Yeah, Roxy does something and then Alina does it and suddenly it's okay.
She does it better, apparently.
But at this point, they enlisted the help of one Mr. Brewmaster and his friend to go and attempt to save their collateral, which he did begrudgingly. Very begrudgingly. He didn't like being an errand boy. The Brewmaster is both the founder and governor of Soru, which is where Roxy's from.
He's a big fan of him.
And also the biggest trade city in Pethuania. So he was a bigwig. And he wasn't a kind bigwig.
If capitalism was a person, it would be the Brewmaster.
Yeah.
Shit, yeah.
You're pretty much.
Also, he's southern and constantly tipsy or drunk. Yeah. Anyway, we then were told that, hey, so how do you know that's true? That information you just told us. And long story short, we were told we had to go and it was infiltrate the information den and like find their source.
Yeah.
And find the true true location. And so back to Conjok we went, but luckily this time we had a teleporter to help us out.
Yeah.
Thank God.
Just one piece of advice for any spellcasters, just as soon as you can, learn greater teleport. Regular teleport.
It's
just in general, it's a lot easier than like finding caravans to team up with.
Yeah.
Sure, you have to have a description of the place, but you can just look in a book or ask around town, and then you don't get bullshit like 5% chance encounters.
Yeah.
Kill your birds.
Now, when we were...
It's been a little bit of it.
The entire campaign from...
We've been... Listen, every time there's something brought up that you've, like, planned or accidentally made happen, we throw shade at you. We've been throwing shade at you this whole time.
Oh, I know.
So,
I know.
Yeah. Now... When we were going in the back way, we were being sneaky about it this time.
Oh, God!
I'm still proud.
I remember that.
Oh, God.
But before we get into that, I just want to point this out. Didn't you kill a homeless person?
I cannot confirm nor deny that. No, actually, I didn't. I left
you
him to die.
You caused his death. You killed him.
Okay, so
you tried to open a door, there was banging, you got out of dodge, but the bundle of rags was alive.
start from the top.
Right,
okay, so we're reconnoitering. We're just kind of reconnoitering. We're loitering outside the Shadow Broker's information broker's hideout. It's a business.
Yeah.
It's the like out in the open. No one cares.
It's a headquarters.
So it's at night, so we're trying to be all shady, as everyone is in Conjok. And you're all standing around in a circle, kind of outside, just keeping watch on the guards outside. There are two posted on either side of the entrance. And I go around the back, just trying to scope out the place, see if there's any other entrances. Turns out there is. There's like a little courtyard out the back. It's kind of fenced off, it's got a gate. And I go into the alley, have to make a listen check, and there's like this homeless guy who's like snoozing in the alley behind me. So I'm like, okay, cool. Wonder if he's a guard. I don't care. So the gate was locked, I think. I picked it easily. And then I try and open it, but I didn't realize that it was rusty and it squeaked.
Yes.
And then I get... Did we have a sending or something? Or did someone come tell me that one of the guards was going to...
You had a couple of friends make a... convenient distraction.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay,
yeah,
so Roxy came out basically because like Roxy was with you at that time because you like came and got
that's right
help. yeah
that's
so,
right
so like the gate squeaked
And the guard came around and was like, what's going on here? Roxy's immediate reaction was to grab Bill and go, I'm sorry, myself and my lover here were just trying to find a nice, quiet place to hook up.
I forgot. Now, I forgot this at the time, but now remembering back, it was this young, handsome half-elf and this crotchety old man.
Listen!
I've got crumbs in my beard.
I forgot completely. Yeah.
Yes.
And I think you joined in on this.
Later on, the girls came around.
It wasn't Cass, it was Alina and Raga.
Yeah, Alina, Raga, and Cass. Came around, they made noise, and Alina's first response was to grab Cass and Raga and go, oh, is the tavern down the street, yeah?
No, Cass wasn't involved in that at all.
I thought she
Cass
was
sitting at the front watching.
Yeah.
Right, so it must have been Lathlian then.
But I wasn't. Yeah. I do remember being
Lathlian and Cass were sitting out there, so it was
right,
just
okay,
Alina
it was just Alina and Raga then,
and
sorry.
And I think once
that's
I
cool.
realised what you were doing, I was totally on board with it,
yeah.
And I just encouraged it,
yeah.
And the guards got very creeped out.
Yeah.
Yeah,
we basically
I'm not paid to deal with this.
That,
I'm not
that
going
basically,
to deal with it.
That pretty much allowed us to, like, get off scot-free with that guard because he was just like, they're fucking doing it again. They're doing it again. God damn it.
Except at the point where, I think it was before that, actually, because I opened the gate and then it squeaked at some point before we actually got into the actual place.
Yeah.
I had to think pretty quickly because there were guards coming around and they would see that the gate is open and I was also there. I... Oh, shit.
What did you do?
I'm not a very good person. I comped the homeless guy. He was asleep, but I made him extra asleep. I knocked him out, and then I heave-hoed his little body of, like, you know, he was homeless, so he was probably light. And I dragged him near the gate, and I leaned him up against the gate, and then I hid, because I'm a rogue. Well, arcane trickster, a roguey person. And, the only context we got for that was the guy coming back around to his post, and the other guard asking him what was happening. And the guy said, don't worry, it was just a homeless person, I took care of it. And all these assholes just looked at me like I'd done something wrong.
Like you just murdered a guy.
Yeah, like
Cass has ever known about that.
No,
and if
she did,
she would probably murder you.
Never will. No one knows about that.
That's the point of lying.
I don't think anyone knows that.
No. I don't think in character, I don't think we did.
No.
You're
so anyway, I think that happened.
Yeah, that happened after that.
Yeah.
But yeah, the whole lovers thing twice. Happened after that.
Just after this poor guy's death.
So
yeah.
There's still a guard in Conjol who thinks there's a very weird foursome or whatever we were pretending.
I'm pretty sure he's forcibly forgotten it.
Good.
And repressed those memories.
Good for him.
Let's go back and do it again.
We should true res the homeless guy.
I think we need his name.
What we need to do is we need to go back to Conjol, find that exact guard, and then like go, whoa! Strange, creepy reunion! And then, like, just get him up to speed on this fictional awesome.
No, he's not there anymore.
No.
He wouldn't be
that's
there.
True.
Oh, that's true.
And forgot about that.
Yeah.
Once you
that's true resident.
So, these guys eventually got into the information brokers.
Yep.
Yeah, this is actually where I've never been more useful.
Yeah.
In this section, because it was basically a stealth mission, and I was the party rogue, so I was going around locking picks and
locking picks,
and trapping fines, and
you did a pretty good job of it mostly as well.
Yeah, I think I only set off one trap, and I knew that I was setting it off because I failed on the disable. So I was like, okay, well, I'm gonna do this, I guess, and. Basically what it was is I opened the door and then I got jabbed with a little pin and it gave me con damage, which was instantly repaired by Raga.
I think
think one of you two. A lesser restoration.
I don't think I had lesser restorations on hand at that point.
Yeah.
And I actually managed to salvage the vial that I got pricked with. So I still have that in my inventory, just rattling around at level 23. Probably someone could just buy.
There's a lot of stuff that we acquired at lower levels that we still have. Moving on.
Yeah.
And one of those was, for some reason, Lathlian kept all of Lils' belongings, including
including
a goblin stomach, I'm pretty sure. Yep. In which Alina ended up with this, and it later came out, and it was putrid and out.
Roxy vomited.
Part of the party
vomited, yes.
Have vomited because they failed checks. Anyway,
it serves
we don't
as a good
need
distraction,
to
though.
Be talking about Lils' putrid
goblin stomach.
Yeah, so on topic.
we ended up finding this door.
Mm-hmm.
And it had like this mark on it, and some of us might have touched that mark and got transported somewhere. And I asked Rictoros, hey, do we need backup for what's behind that next door? Because we're in just a little room by itself. And he was like, yes. And I was like, I was instantly convinced it was Tel'Baras Lair. Instantly. I was like, that dragon is behind that door. I was just like, terrified, and I think that's when we ended that session.
Mm-hmm.
And I think I spent a week convinced that we were going to open that door and find a freaking
boss. Received several threats over Facebook.
He is our end boss, guys.
I never threatened you.
One of them was from you, and you're like, if you kill my character, I'm going to be so upset.
That is an emotional threat.
Yeah.
That's true. I probably did say that. I'm very attached to my character.
You are.
Yes.
I think we're all quite attached to this
yeah,
party.
Yeah, we are.
Mm.
I don't know how attached you are to Bill, but we're attached to Bill.
Y'all can mourn for him when he cocks it.
If he cocks it.
We can only hope.
If he achieves his goal of godhood.
Anyway, it wasn't...
Again, another interest that he just picked up.
Yeah. It wasn't Tel'Baras.
No.
Eventually the party comes through.
Oh, wait, no, this is important, because this is the time that Bill showed mercy and Lathlian killed two people.
No, I forgot about something.
No, that you bring it in
this
when
is...
we get to it.
No, this is... Okay, yeah.
When we get to it, we can cut to you.
Yeah, cool.
Okay.
Sorry.
Oh, this is the thing that I don't know.
This is the thing you don't know.
Oh,
okay.
I'm going to be so flat. I'm just not going to react.
I'll just set it up and then you go.
All right.
Open the door.
What's the reaction?
It's a library with some librarians in there.
So, unless Tel'Baras a big book nerd, it's not his lab.
Yeah.
So, these guys are organizing books on thousands of different information that the information brokers have gathered and sell.
We later learned that each of these books was basically five books in one,
mm-hmm.
magically, which is like, yeah, would have loved to stay there a little bit longer, did not have the time. I was stealthy, Lathlian, our monk, was stealthy, we kind of ducked and weaved a Metal Gear Solid around the bookshelves to try and find the best position to take these guys out. And I went for the non-lethal option of bopping them on the head and just kind of letting them softly fall to the ground.
Yeah.
Lathlian forgot to...
Yeah.
Non-lethal.
He was thinking, you know, it's fine, it's just one hit, it won't kill him, we'll just bop him, this will be okay. Little did he know, these are level 0 commoners, so they had less than 4 hit points.
And he's a monk.
And he's just like, whoop, boop, D8 plus, I think it was plus 4 at that point.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I'm just like, oh, okay, what'd you roll? He's like, oh, I got a 7, and on the next one, you rolled an 8. Like, okay. They're dead.
His fists went through them.
Yep.
So, yeah, I think he only killed one, and I knocked out two. I don't remember
no,
very
he,
clearly.
He
they were
killed
like,
two of them.
He did kill two of them?
Yeah.
There was one because
he had spring attack, and he's just like, kuk, kuk.
What do we do with the last one? Did we just leave him there?
We just left him.
I think, yeah, though,
yeah.
So he's dead anyway.
Yeah.
So,
then we, like, took their robes and disguised ourselves as them, right?
I think we just took their robes because we wanted them.
Yeah.
The found another door that was very mysterious, and you did a legend lore on it, because I think it had another symbol on it.
Yeah.
And the name that came up was Tillywag Gary Nozzle.
Oh, and hang on, I have the thing written down that we actually got from that.
I have written down as well, actually.
I do as well.
That's like
they're
the
already
one,
on it.
Because I usually write down my legend lore sometimes.
The gnome is he who has eyes all over, works for more than coin. Yeah. If you anger him, beware, for Gary Nozzle will not spare any who break a deal and break them bare.
So, you know the deal part? The night before this had all gone down.
Oh, it was the night before.
This was the night before. The very night before. Roxy got visited by Dillywag himself. And was offered a deal. Jerry took me out back and was like, stab me in the gut. No. basically gave me an ultimatum, and I refreshed my memory on
you get to say this.
Yeah.
Okay. He basically said that when the time comes, come to my side, and then I'll give you all this money and stuff. And Roxy was like, what if I refuse? Being like, fuck you. No, not gonna do that. And then he was like, yes?
We had met Dillywag Gary Nozzle before.
Yes.
And the very first time we met him, he offered us a deal, which none of us took except for Roxy.
Except for
Roxy. Did you meet Dillywag Gary Nozzle before?
Yes.
Did you?
Yes.
Oh.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Because
I must be mistaken.
Anyway.
Yes, we did.
We met him before. Roxy recognized the voice.
Can you do this on session time instead of here?
Anyway, so he offered Roxy a deal that was like, come to my side when I ask and I'll give you all this money. And Roxy was like, what if I refuse? Being like, fuck you, don't want any of that. He basically threatened the party and was like, I'll kill your friends if you don't accept this offer. And Roxy was like, now I'm gonna take the offer. So he accepted a deal, took the money, which he put to good use.
Hmm.
He put the money to good use, by the way. Just want to point that out.
Wasn't part of that my armor?
Yeah.
Yes.
That really awesome armor?
Yes.
That was very good use.
You don't
use
it. So anyway.
So yeah, he made a deal to go to his side if he was called.
Hmm. And upon finding out that riddle.
Yep.
On the other side of that door was Dillywag Gary Nozzle.
Roxy was on edge this whole fucking time.
I'm so shocked.
And there was shock on your face before.
Out of character.
We have it on. We have
in
video evidence.
But out of character and in character, we knew nothing about this.
Yeah, we had no idea.
I didn't find out until months afterwards, after the campaign ended, that this had happened.
I thought it wasn't relevant anymore.
anyway,
we're going to have to kill you.
We don't know in character yet.
No,
we didn't know how to get out of this place because we couldn't teleport.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing that we had to escape places didn't work because we didn't realize we were on another plane.
And also, I may have destroyed the teleportation symbol.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yep, they're like, oh, they're going to send reinforcements here. Not if I destroy it.
Which is
well, didn't they?
They didn't send any more reinforcements.
Oh, I thought they
because
did.
They couldn't, because you destroyed the circle.
Oh, did they know on the other end?
No.
Oh.
It just wouldn't work. It was inert.
Yeah.
Oh, I was hoping that,
you
know, send them through, get lost in limbo, splice.
If one side of the circle's broken,
it doesn't
work.
Sent across
the
different dimensions.
That's dumb. I like it. I want them to get...
Yeah.
What if that happened to you?
Well,
I wouldn't care, because that could happen to other people as well.
Anyways.
No.
Yeah.
Because we didn't know how to get out of here, and he wouldn't just do that on goodwill, we could either try and find him, which he was talking himself up real big, and we actually have no idea what his difficulty level was.
He was like two levels above us.
Yeah, we didn't
much.
Know that. So what we did instead was Cass put her soul on the line in order to get everyone out of there. Now, a paladin making a deal with a devil isn't standard, so We spent some time, mostly you, coming up with a contract that basically put Cass's soul as the, what's the word that I'm
collateral.
Collateral.
Collateral. Yeah.
In, so instead of all the party being there, she chose herself to be the, yeah. So, made a deal with him. He would, was to give us aid, and you have the contract, so you can.
I do have the contract.
We're not going to read it out.
No, no.
Are we?
No.
If you like the puzzle here, I will show the people.
Okay. It's fine.
And I got to sign it.
Yeah, you got to sign it.
Paige. Paige. Paige.
I signed it.
With a signature and a signature.
And you can replicate that. For whatever you need to use.
Don't do that.
Pause the video and then sharpen it.
No.
Zoom in, do a CSI thing and enhance.
We got rid of
enhance.
Every
enhance.
Loophole we could think of. I think
yes.
I think Connor did a really
yeah,
good job on
no, it
that.
Was. There was only two loopholes. One of which you couldn't have known about.
Well, mm-hmm. What's the loophole? Can we know now?
No.
Because it's still in
effect. And the other loophole?
And the other loophole was something sort of obscure, but it would have resulted in very minor effects.
Oh, cool.
Oh,
good
yeah.
job.
What was that one?
We can't. No.
Damn it. I was trying to. Yeah, but.
I'm on to you.
So, yes, we ended up getting his help.
So yeah.
Useful.
Very,
useful.
Very strict, kind of regulated help.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
They're like. Clauses in there where I just repeated, this will in no way affect anyone else negatively. This will in no way cause any harm to the environment or children or puppies or anything. It just won't.
But the condition was that we had to take this stone and place it on Telvarus' corpse and absorb. It would absorb the souls. Which I'll talk about the effects of that later.
I should probably mention, it was at this point, or I think it was at this point, that we found out that Telvarus was not just a dragon, but he was a dragon who had absorbed
36
souls and was some kind of demon dragon thing.
He had absorbed 36 souls of extraplanar beings.
One of which was Lilza.
Yeah.
She was absorbed.
Yeah.
She was interplanar.
Yeah.
I also forgot to mention that one of the things from the contract was also... He made a deal with Telvarath to not tell anyone where he was, so Cass actually said, okay, tell us everywhere he isn't. And that's how we got his location, because there was a loophole.
That's the thing I got too excited about earlier.
It was.
Yeah.
It's easy to do, because that's pretty
that
neat.
Clever.
Yeah.
It's the only smart thing I've done.
It's like
the only thing that you've... Like, nothing since.
It's
I mean, that's also on purpose, because of my character's intelligence.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's like the whole thing where a party comes up against like a crossroads demon, and the demon's like, "Ooh, make a deal, more dudes." And the guy's like, "Okay, give us a second, cool." And the demon's like, "Yep, cool. Cool. Our deal is concluded. See ya." And the party leave.
Yeah,
I wanted to give you a second. Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah. But yeah, sorry, I had to interject with that.
Where were we at? You decided to get the information in the creative way that you did.
We're playing charades off camera.
Sorry about that.
Two words.
Someone else can take the
first
rest of
word.
This because this is where my memory gets fuzzy.
Yeah.
Okay.
So he basically... Every time I look over, it's done.
Too slow.
He gave us all a couple of favors, told us everywhere Telvarath wasn't, and teleported us out.
He even gave you a small contingent of devils to call on.
That's right, but that was actually stipulated in the contract.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We got favors as
well.
Yeah.
That's what they just said.
We could call upon a little cohort of. Devils or demons or whatever they were.
Yeah.
Because
part of the contract was that once Telvarath's soul was trapped, that Gary Nozzle got this soul stone and would make sure it didn't fall into anyone else's hands.
Mm.
So he was quite keen on that.
Mm-hmm.
like, and even if he died, even if he went away, there were contingencies in place.
Mm-hmm.
He had to put contingencies in place to make sure that no one got their hands on it.
Yeah, mm-hmm. To the best of his ability.
To the best of his ability.
Yeah.
Which, being two levels above level 9.
We would have been like 11 by this point, because
yeah.
We were 12 when we fought Tolvera.
Yeah, I think we were level 11.
And we're getting very close.
Or maybe we were level 12, because we fought Tolvera almost directly after this.
Yeah. Because we figured, hey, Telvereth can move. So even if we know where he is right now, that doesn't mean he's going to stay there.
Yeah.
Mm.
We already thought of that.
Yeah. So,
We booped back to Ferncombe. I'm pretty sure that's where we got to.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And we were like, hi, everyone that we know.
And some people we don't.
There were a lot of people there at that point.
Yep.
Archibald specifically.
Yeah, well.
Yeah.
No, Archibald wasn't there. He
wasn't.
Was away on mysterious business.
He'd been called away on... He was sent away on his own specific task.
So we told Madar that... we were essentially, we knew where Telvereth wasn't, so we were going to where he was and doing the assassination immediately.
The cool thing that happened was we got back to like Ferncombe's town hall, and there was like a big meeting with all the important people. And then like there was a war table map kind of thing. It was, and then like we looked at it, and like as soon as we were finished talking, the whole map blacked out except this one island, and that was a really cool thing. I just wanted to note.
I remember that. That was very cool.
That was really cool. I loved it.
So they organized to send some forces, because he was in an island that had like caverns going underneath it and caverns going on top. So they organized some forces, the ones that we'd helped recruit, to go on top, and we would go underneath. And it was,
I think it was that the the ones on top were all protected by magics and traps and all sorts of things.
Oh,
that is.
Oh, oh! I have my notes.
Hey.
That, because I took notes of that.
That's the entrance that invaders would take. But the one that Telvereth took was one that was unguarded, and that was underneath the island.
Mm.
You have to go into the water and then up through a cavern system. Because, I mean, it's so hard just disabling all your traps when you go out to get some milk or whatever, and then reapplying all your traps, and then getting your milk, and then coming home and having to disable all your
there
traps
was more to
outside.
It, because remember, they were heading up to not only just disable the traps, but to also place dimensional anchors so he could not flee.
That's right.
I think this is it. They were like... the first level had evocation, conjuration, and abjuration. And the second level had, written here, strong conjuration revolving around extraplanar creatures and teleportation.
So a lot of mobs.
A lot of mobs.
Yeah, we had a scroll to anchor him.
Yeah.
I forgot about that.
That was really cool.
So what we did was I cast water breathing on everyone, and we just swam there. and then...
We sank there and then we swam.
We sank there and then we swam there. Maraga weighs a lot. And... We were we managed to be sneaky enough that I managed to get in a lot of buffing before we fought him, so we all had a lot of lightning resist.
Yeah,
thankfully.
As well as, like, Bear's Endurance and whatever else I threw on people.
All the nice spells, though.
All the nice spells. And he was asleep.
Integral.
Yeah.
So that was fun.
So he still needed to sleep, which means that he could be killed. If you can sleep, you can be killed.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, elves don't. Like, but they can
elves can't be killed.
That's canon fact, Danny. What are you,
talking
about?
I don't know why more people just aren't elves.
I should just leave right now.
Yeah,
like just decide to be an elf.
Yeah.
If you're a half elf, you only half die.
Is it like
the half
down
like,
the middle?
No,
you're just dead.
You just kind of sit there and you're like, well.
Case
you dissociate!
case in point.
Because her essence goes back to Elysium or something.
Yeah, well,
she gets,
that's
because
you're all titled.
That's your other half.
Foresty.
Yeah. Anyway.
Case in point, though, is Lathleen alive? Is Lathleen ever going to die?
He doesn't eat or drink, does he?
No,
and he doesn't need to sleep.
No.
And he doesn't own anything.
Yeah.
So
does Lathleen
he
even
may well
exist?
Just be like
does
a rock.
He,
or
he
something.
Gets power from his pawness.
He took a vow of poverty. He can't own more than like 5 gold.
Technically, it's not
very fucking confused. I heard that as porno.
Yeah, I did.
Which is why I felt I needed to clarify.
I'm sure there's a homebrew class that does get their powers from pornos,
no, okay,
but
let's
not
yeah,
monks.
Yeah,
let's
go
to a different, all right, different all right. topic here.
Anyway, we successfully surprise attacked Helfer out in his own lair, which probably was not the best setting, but he was asleep, so I don't know, kind of.
I mean, it was as good as you were going to get at that stage.
Yeah. And we, I mean, do we want to go over the battle or just summon
Let's go with the, like, briefly summon
I don't really remember the battle.
So,
I remember
the battle step by step. I remember some of it.
But
I remember, like...
The first stage was just him as him.
Yeah.
Like,
second
Tilbreath
stage
playing
was
himself.
Like two different Tilbreaths.
Yeah, there was a Tilbreath that was,
so,
like, real tanky and, like,
yeah,
had big scales. And there was one that was kind of more live but was glowing.
It was Hitmonchan and Hitmonlee.
Basically,
yeah.
But... I decided to use magic on the one that wasn't glowing, which turns out was a good thing, because
yeah,
the one that was glowing was immune to magic.
Mm.
Yeah.
And the other one was resistant to physical damage.
I remember, like, Roxy caved in his skull, and then Raga did something really cool as well.
What did I do?
I remember that, like, you and me did enough cool things that, like, Roxy was next to the body when he was dead.
Well, the third stage was he, like, those two forms disappeared, and
yeah,
then a big bipedal, like, dinosaur
dragon
thing with a sword appeared,
yeah,
and tried to stomp on us.
And Alina taunted him, and I can't remember, did she anchor him, or did one of you two anchor him?
I think
I
anchored.
Yeah, she pretended to have it, too.
That's right!
Yeah,
she pretended to have it, and he focused all his power on her.
That's
to prevent
look at that jawline.
Doing
that's
it.
Look at that chin.
But I had one of the favors from
it's almost got as
Dillywag,
good as
and,
me.
I chose to shield Alina, which was good, because
otherwise
he focused all his power at her, because she
mm-hmm
had fooled him into thinking that she was about to anchor him when she wasn't, and she only survived because Cass had protected her.
No, that's right, he breath weaponed her to
yeah
hell.
Oh, to holy hell, yeah.
Yeah.
And
I started, in that stage, I think I started blinking.
Yeah.
As in the spell blink. She sent me to the ethereal plane, which let me see his soul.
What's that?
And I stabbed it at close range. And I actually cut some souls away,
yeah,
which thankfully didn't have that much of an impact on the contract.
Yeah?
Like...
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it did.
It almost killed me.
Yeah.
Like, it almost fucking obliterated me, but it did... How much damage did that do?
It didn't do damage, it just did stat damage.
No,
yeah,
me hitting the
oh,
soul.
Oh, hitting that.
Because I think that's about...
It took off 20% of his max hit points at that stage.
Yeah.
But it also made him destabilize several points, so he couldn't use certain special abilities, and other ones would have different effects. But there were, he didn't get a chance to use most of them.
No.
And the fight was over fairly soon after that.
Oh, and one of the souls that got away was Lilza.
Yeah,
based on the description.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't know Lilza very well.
Yeah, I mean, we assume it's Lilza. We don't have official confirmation.
I don't
yeah
think I described it to people. I just kind of saw it. Went, okay.
Well,
we just
kind of
went wishful thinking. Really,
yeah,
that,
actually, if you didn't describe it, no one else would know.
No, we did go over it in character, though, because Cass knows about it. And
you
I
described
wouldn't,
as
I don't
much
metagame
as you could.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
It may have been Lilza, it may have been... I mean, Lilza looked like a little demon anyway.
Yeah.
So.
We just kind of went, yeah, no, it was, as far as we're concerned, it was Lilza.
Mm-hmm. Anyway, we kill him.
Oh,
but
Roxy. Now, what was it that got you?
It was a dying thing.
I think it was a death throw sort of thing.
Yeah.
Dying and...
Basically, when he died, his physical form exploded with all of the souls he'd gathered and all of the hellish energy that was welled up within,
mm-hmm,
and sent a wave of energy out. Now, everyone within the range had to make a fort save versus death. Everyone passed, except for someone who just so happened to roll one.
Yep! Bad ones at bad times!
So
Roxy died.
Uh-huh.
And then...
Yeah.
Yeah, we put the stone... What?
Oh, first of all, Cass didn't know what to do because She was very close to Roxy, and Roxy had just, like, died in front of her, and the only other time she'd seen one of her close friends die was Lilza, so this was a shock.
Bill died?
Like I said, the only other close one that died.
Listen, that was, like, for a couple minutes, we had to scrape you off the... But, you know, this was, like,
common.
Yeah. It was honestly an improvement.
Yeah.
So she was a bit, you know, what do I do? But she had to fulfill the contract and put the stone on his body, except you were still in the ethereal plane at this point.
I could see him.
Mm.
No. So, what happened here was... So the stone, when placed upon Telrath's body, created a vortex in the ethereal plane that pulled in all the souls to trap them in the stone. All the souls. All the nearby souls. Someone had died moments ago. Their soul was still, we'll say, fresh.
Mm.
So Roxy's soul began to get pulled into this vortex.
Yeah.
So Bill saw this and...
So I moved, I floated on over, I guess, as you do in the ethereal plane. And because I was still blinking in and out, back and forth.
Mm-hmm.
So what I tried to do is I lovingly reached out and caressed Roxy's very soul.
Yeah.
Held him tightly as my little frail heart. Just clinging to him. Don't go, Roxy. Don't leave us. Except less dramatic than that. And like, I just tried to stop him from being sucked into the...
It was pretty dramatic.
It was a little dramatic. I was literally like hugging your soul, which is kind of weird to think about, but we'll move on.
No,
it's fine. We pretended to be lovers earlier. So.
Yeah. Now, at this point, something that we forgot to mention during the battle was things were looking a little dire, and Archibald showed up with a whole bunch of reinforcements, which was his special quest that he was going on, was he was retrieving troops from Lorassic to help. And one of those, there was a wizard that had a large golem. Now, at this stage, what had happened, well, Bill was struggling to hold Roxy's soul alone. Lathlian used his ability as a monk to meld the ethereal plane for a limited time to try and help hold.
Yeah, because you managed to blink back and tell us about it. Mm-hmm. So Cass was aware that this was happening, and...
But you couldn't stop the soul sucking.
I could.
Beforehand, so, I'd actually...
I could.
It was when I...
By taking the stone off.
Yeah, which would...
Which would break the contract.
So what had actually, what while this was happening, while Lathlian and Bill were trying to stop Roxy's soul going in, Cass had to make a decision. She could keep the stone there, have all the souls be sucked in, including Roxy's, or she could pull it away, all the souls go free, and sacrifice her own soul to eternal damnation to... Do the word Gary Nozzle. He's got a tongue twister in his
head. So that fuck.
So she was desperate, she was upset, and she prayed to Shore and basically said that she would take his place if it meant that he could be saved. And she was keeping an eye on Lathlian, because he was half ethereal, half material plane, so she could see the progress. Basically, as soon as he got close to her, she was planning on pulling that away and sacrificing her own soul. But...
Sure, I came through.
Okay, yeah, so before then, when I'd actually hit the...
The golem. There was nothing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Every time. before when I hit the thing in the ethereal plane, I popped back in and I was like bleeding out my eyes because I'd been hit by all the souls that had come out.
And you were not looking good.
I talked to Iron Speaker, someone or other.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I've got his name written down, I don't have my notes with me. I do, but I can't be bothered getting them.
Yeah, fair.
And I said that he was vulnerable in the ethereal plane and he gave me this kind of nod of understanding. Which was really cool. And...
It's fine, we're at the end.
And, yeah, so he actually casts Blink, which I don't know how he did. He made his golem ethereal, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Sent it to aid us. So now I've got this big, strong metal man just kind of firmly grasping our shoulders and just telling us that it's going to be okay. guys, I'm here. It's okay.
All
for
this
us.
Effort for my undeserving ass.
I know, we should just let you go.
Oh. And so, as things were getting a bit desperate, they were slowly starting to lose grip. The Iron Speaker, who was empowering and controlling this golem, eventually began to lose consciousness from the exertion that he was currently outputting. So the golem faded back into reality and fell inert. Lathlian and Bill began to slowly lose ground. Bill lost grip. And eventually, Lathlian was holding on as the last ditch thing. Moments before the vortex shut off, Lathlian lost his grip. And at that moment, Roxy's soul began to fall into the vortex. And there was a sudden flash of white light.
And we all died.
Everyone died. There was actually just a nuke going off. So the vortex closed, sealing all the souls into the stone, bar Roxy's, as some outer force had intervened due to the prayers of one of the faithful in the group. And with that, Roxy was brought back to life. And many tears were had.
I also used heal on Bill after that.
One of the fun effects of heal is that it cures insanity.
Yeah. So that was a very dramatic and very...
It was kind of glossed over because of everything else
that
had happened. But, like, yeah.
That was a big shift.
We actually asked Jeremiah, like, would that actually affect what he has? And he was like, and you were like, yeah. You'd actually feel a little bit more clear-headed. You feel like you can actually think without going off on 15 different tangents. So I had to, before then, Bill was chaotic neutral. I actually gave him an alignment shift to true neutral to kind of reflect his stabilizing...
A little more grounded.
Grounded personality. But he's still a little bit off kilter. I think he's just strange for the heck of it now.
Yeah, well.
He's just a freaky old man because he's a freaky old man now.
Yeah, he's just like messing with people.
But yeah, so after the tearful reunion of everyone gathering around Roxy as he slowly kind of woke up, very sore.
Being like, ooh, that was a hell of a trip.
Not quite understanding how close he'd come.
The soul gem did get taken. During all that, we actually did summon some. I had to call Dillywig and be like, hey, can you send me reinforcements now? And he's like, yeah, sure, I guess. So he sent over two demons or devils. Or was it a chain devil and someone else?
There were three chain devils and one devil. We'll refer to them as a lieutenant in this case.
Okay. So the lieutenant went over and took the gem and, as per instructed in the contract, just booped out on out without doing anything else.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
So that was gone. That was out of sight, out of mind, as far as we were concerned at that moment. And you told us something out of character that we wouldn't know.
Hmm.
You said that if Roxy's soul had actually been pulled in with Telvarath's, that would nullify the contract, and your soul, Cass's soul, would have been forfeit anyway, because it wouldn't just be Telvarath's soul there, which is what we had bargained for.
Yep.
It would have been in surplus, it would have been not what the contract was specifically, and it would have been just completely voided.
If it had gotten too close, in Cass's opinion, she would have pulled that away, but thankfully it didn't have to happen.
Yeah. So it was missing a few souls.
Yeah.
Are we allowed? Are you gonna let us know how that affected things? No.
No, that one's. No, not that one.
Huh. Okay.
All right. That's...
Not anyone, really.
Reassuring.
I mean, you can ask plenty of other things. I've answered several things here that you didn't already know.
Yeah. Mm.
Ooh, but fun thing, I found a Holy Avenger there that used to belong to James.
Yeah.
Yeah.
As well as a loot.
That happened to be...
We also found bodies.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, the loot was on some bodies.
Yeah.
Small.
The Holy Avenger was, like, hidden behind some evil magic.
And their clothes one of our party members is wearing most of one of their outfits, I think, still.
No, I think she's changed clothes.
Yeah, she got rid of some of it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
She's got new digs.
Yeah. So, yeah, we found a whole party there, just dead. Like, their corpses.
Yeah, our technician is freaking out.
I still have a saddle over there as well.
There was a...
Oh, and because of that, now our party are all much closer because I found a headband of telepathy that we use to this day. With Cass as the...
We also found a nest of dragon eggs that had been killed when they were still dragon eggs. I managed through some... I'm actually kind of proud of how I managed to figure out which dragon eggs were good and which ones were probably not good that I wanted to bring back. But I managed to actually revive one of these dragons, and it was a little bit not right because it had managed to kind of grow, mature to the point where it was should have been born, but it was okay. And we managed to get it into the hands of someone that we thought would look after it and keep it safe. And I very recently discovered that was not the case.
We don't know what happened to it.
So
we can guess.
Spent a year being very proud that I was basically a mother of dragons. And now I'm not.
Roxy was like, he was like cradling it the whole time.
I know,
he was like,
but did you breastfeed it like Raga did?
And it's not true. That is.
That may be your headcanon, but it's not actual canon.
Yeah, that's another story.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was upsetting.
I do have a question. How come Gary Nozzle picked him to make a deal with?
Why do you think?
Because he's the most easily influenced out of all of us.
Boy!
He would do stuff just for the heck of it.
But he's a spiteful old man.
Shit,
true.
Unpredictable.
Yeah.
You're like the only constant.
And
like,
besides, he'd already made a deal with him before.
That's true.
Yeah.
That
makes sense. Okay.
He's a known buyer.
He wouldn't have gone for Cass.
Oh, no.
Mm-mm. He's not an idiot. That's dumb.
Exactly. Cass would train Schenken.
I mean, Raga was an idiot.
Yeah,
but
he'd already made a deal with someone in the party already, so why try and grease another's palms when you can go through the same?
Because then you can get a half a party on your side.
Yeah, maybe he doesn't want that, though.
Shut up.
Maybe, does he have like a loyalty
I choose
card?
To believe that means I'm valuable,
I'm
honestly.
I'm just very glad
you
chose to.
Get a hole punch with each deal, and like your 10th deal is not free.
Anyway, I'm just glad that we actually made the deal instead of having to fight her, because we would have had to fight Roxy.
Yeah! Yeah.
Would you have had a choice? No.
No,
he wouldn't
have
had a choice.
If he didn't go, then you guys would have just been killed.
I'm so sad I didn't get to shank you.
Like, if I'm pretty sure, like,
one day.
They're still
if
trying.
He,
one day.
If like, Roxy had refused to go to his side, what would have happened? Would he have just dropped dead?
Well, I can't really tell you that.
You can't?
No.
No,
still in
he can't.
That's right.
Yeah.
Because
the other half of a certain someone that's still active in this world.
Yeah, that'll
which
be.
Is
we can't talk
why?
About.
We
yeah.
can't. Yeah, we're
not
under.
That's why
that.
I'm still.
Disclosure agreement.
Wait a few months, guys.
Yeah, but when you told me about it and this came up, I was just like,
oh,
shit.
Oh, Roxy's never saying anything about this, because as far as he's concerned, it's fine.
It's
just like a homeless man in an alley.
And everyone's
going to
be like, betrayal.
Yeah.
Especially Cass.
Yeah.
Don't you do this to Cassiel.
Listen, I've already done enough to her.
We were level 12. Telvereth, I don't know what challenge rating he was or what level he was, but...
He was designed for around your level. Like, it was designed as a hard encounter, but something you could have beat. Like, that entire campaign was aimed to have you guys finish at level 13.
Mm-hmm.
You finished at level 12, so it wasn't too bad.
Yeah. We finished at level 12 with, like, one of us leveling up, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, who was that?
I think
that
was Roxy.
Yeah.
Someone.
We stormed his place, and each round is just like 6 seconds, so we worked it out to be under a minute.
Yeah.
That we just rocked up on his...
I think it was under 30 seconds.
Yeah.
No, it was under a minute.
It was under a minute. It was like 14
thunder.
Rounds.
Fucking killed in less than 60 seconds.
Yeah.
Yeah, we... and then Archibald's forces were there for like the last 4 rounds.
Anyway, we... went back to Ferncombe. We were declared the heroes of Ferncombe.
Yeah.
Yeah, you fixed a problem that you caused.
We got a lot of gold from that cave.
Yeah.
And we gave like half of it to the town. And now they're having a they've got a booming economy.
Fernclimb is no longer just a village. It is now a city / town.
It's doing great.
It's doing good. I'm so proud.
Alina wrote a song about Raga and stuff.
Yes.
Ballad of Sir Raga.
Oh no. Okay, so I should say that one of Raga's main motivating factors when she first wanted to become an adventurer was to become cool and famous and just awesome in general. Her motivation has changed now, but I'm still a little bit of that. So when this was first started, she was kind of like, I'd like if you sang about the whole party, but I'm on board with this.
Now she's taken it a bit too far.
Her opinion of the song has also now changed.
Every 5 seconds. We meet someone new, Alina just goes, I play the Ballad of Sir Raga.
Yeah.
She hasn't written another song.
She has.
It's like the only song.
She wrote another one.
She's written more than one.
When? And when did she play it?
She wrote one with Cass in it.
Yeah.
Does she ever play the Ballad of Sir Cass?
No, there is no Ballad of Sir Cass.
That's because you're not a sir. I'm the only sir
you
in our party.
Yeah, you got knighted.
Yeah, I am knighted.
Cass is very proud of Raga.
Mm. Oh, thank you. Raga's proud of Cass.
Well, when it happened, like... It was like a big,
yeah. She won a tourney.
Yeah,
Bill is sad. Roxy wasn't there for that. No. I had commitments, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway. Sometimes real life takes precedence over.
It shouldn't.
Well, I mean, yeah. Okay. Well, that's the story of Telvarath, and of the heroes of Ferncombe.
Does Ferncombe have a statue of Raga in it?
Oh my god!
No, it does not.
Does it have a statue of Roxy?
No!
Roxy will commission one.
No!
I mean, you probably could.
I could make it now.
But we'll finish up for now. Thank you all for listening. Watching this time.
And listening.
And thank you guys for coming along.
You're welcome. I enjoy exposure.
So do I.
You just love attention.
I do!
Alright.
I'm not a fucking attention specialist.
Catch you next time.
Good night.